That's all right. Zio Kiddushin would say that's all right. And it is all right, Israel. I certainly can relate to Ach David as he uttered in the beauty of the Tehillim with the Shiram, the song of great gladness. He said to Omar, yeah, I will praise, I will halel. And he said, I will praise you with great excellence, with lev kol, with my whole heart. He said, and I will do that before the gods. Before the gods of the earth, the gods that have their supremacy. And he said, I will jeer with my voice, with the sound of accolades. He said, and I will sing praises unto my Abba. That's all right. I like that. There's nothing in the Torah that I despise, because a wise man, he loves the discipline of the Torah. And that's why he meditates day and night on the disciplines of the Torah. And the sure sign of that wise man, as Shirach expressed, that a wise man, you can tell he is wise by the isha of his ponim, about his face. You can be the damn hypocrite all you want to and pretend. I'm going to teach on the elements one day soon of a wise man and a zachim. It's because the men have not taken their rightful place, and I'm talking about the gebah, men of strength, men of pure attitude when it comes to the disciplines of Almighty Yahweh, that they exercise themselves in the discipline of the Torah, their minds in the discipline of Emunah and wisdom. The wise man, his pony, his face express the Isha, the riches of his delight in Torah, because it shows that that man has great understanding, not a damn simpleton and a silly man. For his countenance doesn't express the beauty of Yah. It doesn't. And I don't give a damn if you don't love me. You don't care for me, I will reprove you and show you the ignorance and the silliness of your immature ways. We need a Geba or a Geba man. He is a warrior of Torah, not just verbally or in verbiage. You see it in his walk. You see it in his talk. You see it in the imminence of his presence when he's in the midst of men. When he speak, the nations listen. Would he talk men that are wise in intellectual matters? They listen. And that's a fact. But a fool think that he or she is heard because of their much conversation. What has happened? I'm going to deal with that today. We greet you all, our friends of Yisrael. We greet our enemies as well. We appreciate you for the attentiveness you give unto the messenger of Yah. I was thinking that if I wanted to be a man of a sumptuous lifestyle and living what the world called well, I could do it with the best of them. I don't have to ride the people for money, beg them. I know how to do it. Because just the intellectual appeasing of the mind and the appearance means more than anything. And I know what I'm saying. It's a fact. But I prefer the preference or the choice of Moshe. He chose rather to suffer with the Am, the people, the nation of Yah, than to enjoy the pleasures of sin, the pleasure of one's own excitement, the pleasure of one's own hafit, their pleasures and will. He chose rather to endure whatever afflictions that the nation of Yisrael would encounter and to abandon all of him for the nation. And that's what I have done in my premature, short-lived life. Because the substance of this life, they don't mean a damn thing to me. Not one damn thing. And I'm talking about the material gluttonous of a nation. I'm talking about family and friends, wife, children. I will choose none of that before Yah. I will not obfuscate my responsibilities unto Yah. For no one. Whether you like me, love me, I frankly don't give a damn. Yes, I said I don't give a damn. How about that? Greetings again to all of the Beit Yisrael scattered puts throughout the Erech, throughout the four corners of the earth. May the testimony of Yahshua speak to you this day as we greet you all wherever you are. We greet you in Yahshua's name, our precious Ach, Zachin, Charles Davis. I will have your name when I come to California. We greet you, our precious friend, all of your great kindness, your gifts. We greet you. We greet you, our Ach, Kevin Wines. May the riches of Yah rest upon you for your faithfulness, your kindness, your generosity, as well as our Zachin Tayonia, your faithfulness. It speaks volume. He's always pressing to do more. He says to me, I want to do more, man. We're not complaining about what you're doing. Our friends, you that are with us, the few, hallelujah. We greet you all. Yahshua's mighty name, we greet you. May Yah's riches, we greet you as well. Our friend Cherie Moore and your mother, your precious daughter there in Chicago, our Aunt Lester. There in Chicago, our friends scattered abroad, your faithfulness. Our Ach David there in Indiana. And also as well as our Ach Wim and his wife, Ochol Tiffany, and all of that kaburul of youngins. It's about 10 of them. We greet you, my precious Ochol Marianne and also Miriam. We greet you all wherever you are. Our Ach Yaakov, we're glad that you made it safely home, as well as our precious friend Achya Achub there in McKinney, Texas. Yah keeps you and watches over you in your travel. We greet you in Yahshua's mighty name for your great kindness, your chotros, your children. He has been a kind man over the years and faithful. And our precious friend Achmikaya, we're going to pray for him. He twisted his back, I believe, getting out of the vehicle, and he's having tremendous pains. Let me say this before I go further. He is one of the only men that I've met over the many 25, 30 years of preaching, over 30 years of preaching. He is one of the only men that have come here and visited us. It is faithfulness. He has been the quietest of all men. He keeps his mouth shut. He has learned by the pattern of example. He doesn't show his proudness of what he thinks he knows. And he's wise beyond our concept of what wisdom is. Because he will come to the office, we will sit down in the wee hours of the night. And I listen to him talk as we talk together. He has not, I've watched in this community over the last nearly 20 years. I watch the prophets, the apostles, I watch them come, and they all are little boys because they want to show what I know. And I watch men here always wanting to show someone that come that they're much more superior than them. And they are not. That they have a wise mentality of Torah and they don't have a damn thing, a wise man. When you see a matter of strength, you see it in his visage, his eyes. That's right, mama. You see it in his countenance, the Esher, the Oshir, the riches of his wisdom. It speaks volume of his happiness. Not this silly LeGrand that we have. That doesn't mean a damn thing. He's the only friend of ours. As I've watched men to come say they love me, when they say that, he has never told me he loved me. He has never. Aunt Mikaya, you're sitting there. He doesn't tell me that, how much he appreciates me. He shows me in the volume of his actions. And the volume of his speech. When others talk, he gets quiet and listens. He's the only man that I've met, and I've watched them come. See, they love me, they submit. I've watched them, my Ima. My Ima Sabir said that. When these men come, they will find out what manner of man they are. That is the truth, mama. It is the truth. So boys like to show boys what they know. Men, they are the example of what they know. That's what a Gerva is. He has a cause that is greater than him. And our Akmikaya in his pains, he's a beautiful man. You don't meet them like him. And that's a fact. You don't meet them like that man. I have corrected his wife. I've told her, no, not here. He has never rose up against me. Neither has she. I think about his son, Sophonia. And I watch my Zakin here as Shimri, as he, in his ailment, that he has almost like a father taking this lad under his wings, and he appreciates that. This man greets him when we all gather here. He takes the pleasure and opportunity to make sure that this young lad, in all of his agony, that we tend to forget because he's sitting back there. I appreciate that. I said to him, I understand your agony, son. I said to his avat, yes, he may at times rail because of his great agony. You would too. And I would too, man. So you don't discount that. You don't think that he is not one that loves you because of that. This is a damn stupid generation. I despise it. David said, I will praise your name. I will exalt you, my Abba. I will esteem you. I will praise you with my whole heart. He said, among the gods, we see the God of this earth, this homo devious demonic power, these faggot ball players and faggots, insane individuals that you're trusting the minds of the development of your child, your children. These teachers texting their nudity to students, 14, 15 years old, 12 years old. What is a damn twisted mind like that? And laying hands on your babies. It's wrong, Yisrael. The reason why? Because where are the government? Where are the strong men? Where are the men that stands in the midst of their council and denounce them? And when they denounce them, they fear them. We don't have the government. And so the gates have become slack. The shecha, the gates of the city, the gates of our minds, the gates of our pleasure, they languish. Because we got immature men today. They don't understand the strength of Yah. They are men that like to play with each other. I'm going to teach today. It is the Nidah. It is the Nidah. the nidah, the uncleanliness of the minister woman, she has no right in the assembly. The nidah, I know you genuineness, and you smart ones think you know Torah, you think you understand. Well, a woman on her period should not go into the house. They speak with such great ignorance. They're unlearned men, and they don't know a damn thing. It is the nidah woman, her composition, her mind, her attitude, and this monstrous spirit that is in her, this monstrous tanin, the spirit of death, darkness, the spirit that is a monstrous spirit. Well, it's only in the Ishaw? No, that's not what the Torah teaches. Hallelujah. That's not what the Torah teach. It teaches something greater than that. So we greet you all. Friends, I want you to stay with us as Reach Taivi began to teach. I want us today, I want to begin here, Yisrael, this nidah, the uncleanliness, the vileness, the perverse corruption, this minister flaw, this issue. I want you to retain that word issue. It is zub, zub. We must understand what the word issue implies in Torah. You must understand, so this nidah woman, that the blood flows, the uncleanliness flows. It is a continuous uncleanliness that it produces a monster, and she becomes a monster. I want you to follow along with me, and I will tell you what to turn. Because I want to read, first of all, out of the book of Ezra, the third book of Ezra. When y'all talked about a time and an hour whereby the way, the derech, how to walk in HaTorah, he says it shall be hidden from the people, especially Yisrael and the masses of the people. The word that Yah used, it is called Ivreh or Ivileh. It is the blindness of one's mind. It is the blindness of knowledge, and they don't know. So the Nobi speaks so precisely, and he tells us that there shall be a spirit of Nahash, this unclean, vile thing that rises from the bosom of the Nidah, the unclean, the minister woman that has an issue that flows from her. It says in the book of Ezra, hear this, 3 Ezra 5:8. Yah says, there shall be hafer, the minds shall be confused. Where envy and strife is, there's confusion, and every evil worker is what Shaul says. So he says, there shall be hafer, there shall be confusion, there shall be a confoundness of ignorance. They shall not have the ability to bring forth the understanding and the wisdom of the Torah. He says also in many, in Ra'ab, in the abundance of the places, it shall be. And Yah says, and the fire shall often be sent out. And the wild beasts shall change their places. He's talking about this Tanim and this Nahash, the spirit that says, I am great, I am God, I am the mighty one, I am one of great strength. That is a beastly spirit. It is the same nature of the serpent, that he was the most subtle creature in the garden that Yah had created. And not only that, the Nobi says, he says, and the Nidah, the minister, the woman, the Nidah woman, she shall bring forth monsters. In the natural sense, parents are bringing forth monster children too. Sure it is. What does that imply? Can we read that in the figurative? Can we read it in the actuality? Can we read it in the metaphoric expression of this to understand? Can we? Which one is right then? The figurative? The metaphoric, the actuality, which one is right? Which one is right? They all are right. He says that the bleeding woman, the one that has this zub, this issue that flows continuously out of her, she shall bring forth the monsters. She shall bring forth this nahash, this tanim, this spirit that rises up against Yah and says, I'm a god. I have supremacy. I have the power to elect to choose and do what I so choose to do. This is what she shall bring forth. This is what shall be produced out of her. It shall be a tanim, a monstrous spirit, that you will see the revelation of that in all of her fruit, in all of her ways. Is this specifically talking about just simply the Ishwar? We'll define it in Torah and see if it is. See, ignorant men will read that and they got understanding immediately. A wise man, he ponders, he searches for hours and days. He doesn't speak until the time is appropriate, when the revelation of this truth is revealed through the power of the testimony of Yahshua. And when he speaks, he has not pondered the order of his procession of his speech. He speaks by the Ruach HaKodesh. Not this damnable, silly generation today. Hear this now. She shall bring forth monsters. Is there any other witness of that kind of thing that shall eclipse in the time or the hour we're in? Well, Jeremiah, he wrote a letter to Baruch, his secretary. And this is what Jeremiah says to Baruch. We talking about the Nidah, the uncleanliness that is vile. He says in 1 Baruch, chapter 6, verse 29, he said, this shall be in the hour. He talks about the minister woman. He talks about the nidah, the woman that is unclean. He says, the nidah, the minister woman, and the women in childbearing, he said, they eat their sacrifice, not their zabach, but they eat their sacrifice. He said, by these things, many know that they are not of Almighty Yahweh. They're not of the zira, the seed of Almighty Yah. He says, fear them not. Now, who eats their children but the beast or that which comes forth out of it? A female dog will eat the offsprings that she senses that they do not have the strength to survive. Every form of beast will do that. And that's why the messenger Ezra says that the minister woman, she shall bring forth this nature of a monster. She'll be a monstrous, this tiny. That's what this word serpent and the serpent tanim. It shall bring forth this guile of the nature of her sharp tongue. It shall bring forth the same nature, the same spirit, the same mindset of her sharp tongue. We're talking about the Nidah woman. And the Nidah, the unclean woman, Yisrael, she shall eat. You did not touch the showbread in the house of Yah. You shall eat, and yet Yahshua said, eat, for my body is flesh indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. But the Nidah, the unclean one, she shall eat her offering, her sacrifice. But that does not give us any kind of conclusion or conclusive evidence of what is being experienced here, because I don't see it in the book that I'm so accustomed to. Well, okay, well, I give you a reading of the Torah that you're accustomed to. It's in Lamentation. Lamentation or Echa. Lamentations. In chapter 4 and verse 10. Amen. It says in Lamentations chapter 4, verse 10, it says that the hands or the yards It talks about this woman that is Rachmani, the pitiful woman. A woman that is loving. A woman that is full of compassion. A woman that is inspired by the beauty of her children. It is talking about the woman that is Rachmani. She is compassionate. She loves her children. She loves the things of God. It says, and the pitiful woman, she have bashal, she has sad. She has boiled, she has baked, she has fried. Who? Their own babe, their own children. So that gives me a witness of what was said with Ezra, and what was said in the writing of Jeremiah unto Baruch. Does it not? Sure it does. It says that this woman that is pitiful, full of compassion, full of caring, full of love, she shall sod and she shall boshal, she shall boil, she shall bake, she shall roast. Who? It says their own children. You boil the tanim, the beast. You fry the lamb's meat. You cook Yisrael, the chicken and the fish from the ocean. She shall cook her own child. She shall boil her own child. And why? They were the meat in the destructions of the daughters or the daughter of my people. Is he talking about his people? He's talking about Yisrael. Yeah. It was the rewards for the destruction of my people because they have defied the Torah. That's why the minister, the ministering woman, or the woman with the nida, with the issue, with the zub, the issue that flows, she shall bring forth monsters. Is this not the woman that shall escape into the bimitzbar for time and a season? And Yah shall raise up the floods of the water, the living power of Torah to guard her. Was he talking about just a natural woman or the physiological state of Yisrael, his bride, the bride of Yah? Well, we will prove it out in Torah. That's why Yah doesn't give this. Who's going to teach the knowledge of Yah? Those that just come out the titty nipola. Hell, their men can't even remember the smallest of things. Yet they remember everything about Torah. That's silly. None of us can't even remember our Hebraic names. But we know much when it comes to Torah. No, you don't. I don't care who you are. Hallelujah. You can't remember Bazia, Imabazia, Yosh Hashanah. You can't remember Yosef. You can't remember Yeremiah. We can't even remember that. Can't go around the Torah. You got a skillful man standing before you. I must prove this out. And if I don't prove it out in Torah, I'm a liar. Well, there are many that have come and said they love me. And they cared for me, my Bath of Zion. Especially men. That I find them to be false as hell. The last one that came, that was so prominent in his relic of his words, I said to my Ishaf, spending 2 hours with him, I walked to the bedroom, I said to my Ishaf, this man is Ricky Bynum 3 times over. Shut your mouth, woman. But I will not judge him accordingly. I know what he is. And he would always say to us that that man knows my heart. I did. Did you all hear him say that? He knows my heart and my heart is right. No, it ain't right. And so when I rebuked him one day to show him what you said is wrong. Now I've allowed you to do that. Now let's sit down in the book and I will go with the precepts. You said that. But that's not what the word says. You said that. Look at what it says here in this witness. Look at what it says here in this witness. Look at what it says here. Look what. He could only say, you were right. I see. But he was not willing to receive the muzan, the correction. Most silly men don't like that. They like to instruct. They don't like any kind of correction. And if you had something that wise, I watched those that were here. If they had something so wise, they're so apt to go to strangers that they don't even know them. Why not teach these young men? Why haven't they taught us and showed us, not only by example, but by their words? Because these young men can reduce them. Because they don't have a damn thing. And that's the fact. And so they've always sought out strangers of those that come before us to show them what they know. That's a near-time woman. She's unclean. I will prove it. The plethora of my wisdom about life I share with my young men. And I do the talk and I said, you all be quiet. Because for his son, he can do the same. His son. I've watched the men that lived here that every time someone come, they want to share and show, pronounce who I am, look at what I know, and they don't know a damn thing. And so you got this competitiveness to see who knows the most, and neither one of them know a damn thing. Because when a man knows something, he walks with a stride that is so pronounced. And that's how I walk. I don't care if I got on dirty blue jeans. I don't care if I'm dirty. It makes no difference. That's the way I walk because I know who I am. Broke as they come, but I know who I am. Don't have a dime. No heritage, but the heritage of truth I can leave her. That's it. You understand? You'll find out just how much you love me when you sit among me. Always tell me, don't tell me you love me. Don't tell me you stand by me. Because that door is open. Once you say that, the door is open. Listen to this. Hallelujah. Can I teach a little bit? Hallelujah. In the same book of Lamentation in chapter 1, I want to show you Yisra'iyah, how she is represented in Torah. You must take upon all the nuances to understand what is in the Shemot, Bimidbar. You can't just read to understand. Look what it says here in Lamentation chapter 1. And verse 17, he talks about Sion or Tizayon, Sion. And the word Tizayon, Sion, it is the prophetic name. It is the name of such great beauty for the city of Yerushalayim. Jaslach Yechuran. It is the idyllic and the most profound name for Yisra'iyah. That name, Yechuran. Yeshurah, it represents the characteristics and the beauty of a nation that Yah has elected. And so he calls her Yeshurah. Yeshurah. So she is the idyllic prototype, what Yah wants. That's why he calls us Yisra'iyah. We are the prototype because we prevail against all opposition. So he gives us here in Lamentations, in Echa, in Lamentation, he gives us the wisdom of Yerushalayim as she is represented, portrayed here as one that is under the power of Shabi, captivity. And we're captive, are we not? We're captivated by everything but Torah. We're captivated by ourselves. We're not captivated by Torah. So he gives us this as she begins to wail and bewail her state in lamenting. And she's seeking Yah for his racham. For his great intervention of his mercies, his kindness. So she is portrayed here in Lamentations 1:17. He says, Sion, spread forth her hand, and there is none to comfort her. Yah has commanded concerning Yaakov that his adversaries should be round about him. And look what he says. Does it say Yerushalayim in the next word? Does it say Yerushalayim? Does it say Jerusalem? It says Yerushalayim is as a what? Minister woman. She is as a minister woman. She is a woman that is on her ministry. That's what she is. That's where his place, whereby we as a nation, we gather in the city of Yerushalayim for me. That's where she is. And so we are a people that are ignorant. We've been taught by concepts that we're developed of our own and they're damn stupid. You gotta search the Torah like it's a gem of gold. That this is her. Now, most men will never find that because they're limited in their ability to seek out the riches of Yah. But they want to dispense out of their ignorance. I don't give a damn who you are. You don't have to say, oh man, I'm darling, I'm touching you and you that are listening. Hallelujah. 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 Does it say she is as a nida, a minister, woman? Does it say that my ach, my re'ach, Yosef, she is as a minister, woman? She is as a minister, woman. She is a woman that minister. And that is the time to alleviate the body of those contaminants. What a beautiful system to purify us. It only comes by the dam. And the blood must pass. You teach your young daughters the concept of that. You don't wait hell until they began to experience that, silly mama. Hell, they can understand computers and all of that. You tell me you can't teach them those things that are vital to their growth and their maturity, silly woman. Yerushalayim, his Sihon, his beloved, his city where he placed his name. She is a minister. Woman. That's what she is. She's as a minister woman. Among those that have brought her into Shebi captivity. Listen to what he says. It says, Almighty Yahweh is Sadiq. That's what we must speak. And I have rebelled against his Torah. We will never say that, would we? It's almost like this. I was thinking the other day as I'm trying to connect Torah, Chatu, verses to the whole of this teaching. I don't ponder how it will proceed from me. I can't do it. I can find scripture, but I can't say or think what I'm going to say. I've never had that distinct ability. There are men that can, and I applaud them for that. I cannot. I can't do it. It's almost like a fat man standing before his boy and say, how'd I look with that on? The boy say, Big Daddy, I don't know, man. What's wrong with it? He gets offended because you tell him the truth. I wore this before me and them girls say, all on me. Nah, Big Daddy, that ain't gonna play. I ask my wife, I say, how does that match? She say, I said, what's wrong with this woman? She said, you asked me, Rhea. I said, okay, let me get the issue. What about that? Woman, I shouldn't even ask you. What about this? That's better. Oh, that's even that much better than that right there. So we get very offended, don't we? Sure we do. That's what Yisrael, that's why they don't understand that rebelling against the Torah. I'm teaching you Torah. You don't rebel against that. And so they rebel against the Torah of Almighty Yah. I have rebelled against the Torah. Shema, here I pray you all people. And behold, my great agony. He says, my virgins and my young, my Beth-Ula. Those that have not touched man, my Beth-Ula and my young men, they're gone into Shebi. They've gone into captivity. Isn't that so among the nation? Our virgins are captivated by the world. They've gone into captivity. Our young men are doing things that are so unnatural to the cause of the physiological, their bodies, to satisfy an urge or need for the moment. It is so vile. It is so filthy. Even the older men are doing that because they cannot contain the sickness of their mind. We're talking about the issue, the nida. The nida. To show us what Torah says, we must understand that, the fullness of it. All right. It says, I call for my lovers. I call for those. I'm bleeding, but I call for those that love me. Aha, my lovers. He says, but they all or they have Ramah. They have deceived me. They have dealt treacherously with me. They have not dealt upright. They have not dealt with an inspiring heart. They have dealt treacherously. They have dealt with such callousness. They have not dealt with me as though they cared for me, they love me. So a wise man will love you and teach you Torah because he has it in his heart. He doesn't despise Torah. When he's corrected, you correct a wise man, he loves you. Yeah. A fool will despise you. He will reject you, but not a wise man, not a wise Beth Zion. He says, my Chohim, the messengers of my tabernacle, he says, am I Zakein of the elders? We have Zakein, we have elders. He said, they have gave up life of the Ruach, the Nefesh, in the ear, in the city. The hearts are not in the city of Yerushalayim. She is a ministering woman, but the heart is not there. She is the woman of Nidah. They have gave up the city while they sought their own ochel, their own meat, to relieve their nephews. Everyone is seeking their own, isn't it? And that's what the elders and the Kohim represent here. Everyone is seeking their own ochel, the meat or the substance, to make them have some sense of assurance and some sense of strength and some sense of identity, as though that they possess something of great essential and character and quality. Yeah? And hell, it doesn't even feed them. Because if it fed them, then they will be fat. They will have the Eshah, the happiness of Yah, that permeates in their counter. They will not, a wise man doesn't have to be reminded of the thing over and over and over and over. You teach a wise man, he becomes wiser. You show a wise man how to do something, you don't have to repeat it over and over again. And there among Yisrael, you got to say the same thing over and over and over and over and over. And they are trying to teach those when they need to be taught themselves. Trying to be a teacher, and they need to be taught. You got to say the same things over and over. You do that with children, not with a wise man. The Nidah spirit, we must define it. Oh, that's for a woman when she's on her ministration. She can't touch nobody. She can't come into the house of Yah. Let us find out what that is. If we're going to define everything by letter upon letter, we must define the whole by letter upon letter. Right, Smachot? All right, I'm going to make it easy for you, okay? Hallelujah. They have gone and they have searched for their own meat. Well, that doesn't give us any clarity as to the nation being a woman that is of Nidah. She's an unclean woman. Well, I believe that the Naomi Yeskel, he could give us a little more insight. Do you believe that? Yeah. Well, let's turn there to Ezekiah Yeskel. Hallelujah. Yeah. Ezekiah chapter 36, verse 16. It says, moreover, the Dabarim, the word of Yah, came to me saying, he called him a Geba, son of man. He says, when Beit Yisrael dwelt in their own land, when they had their own land, when they had the promises, Ezekiel 36, 17, when they had the promises of the Torah, when they dwelt in their place that I promised them, he said, they defiled it. They defiled it. They defile it. We're talking about the Nidah, the ministering woman. They defile that. This is how Yah identifies her. And if I cannot prove her without doubt, in the renewed covenant, I'm a damn liar and wrong. It says that they defile their own land by what? Their doings. See, we don't believe that by our own doings, how we defile Yah's land. By their own doing, he says this now again. He says, their way was before me as an unclean, a tum'ah, a filthy ministering woman, or a removed woman, a nidah. That's what that word removed means. It is a nidah woman. So he talks about the city and the people as a whole. She is a ministering woman. She cannot come into the bay at Aviah. Do you understand? She is a ministering woman. She has an isha. She is removed. She is separated. That's what the word nidah implies. So you can't define it by just looking at one word. There's a plethora of words and surrounding words to express that, because he has hidden this from the wise and the prudent, my bath, and has revealed it unto a simple clown like me. We were sitting at the dining table the other day, and my friend, quite breadth of my statement, my friend Abner, he began to, he said, Rhea, he be acting like a fool, like a nut. I said, boy, hold up now. He said, Rhea, you said that the other day. You said you act like a nut when you get out in the morning. And you get out there and you said you act like a nut. This was his way of getting me, huh? That's what he said, my Akshim Rhea. You may need to talk to him, all right? He said, you said that. He said, Papi, you said you act like a nut. So I had to stir up my impure mind by way of truth, you understand? I said, boy, you got me on that one, huh? Okay, then, I act like a nut, then. He said that his nation is like a woman that is removed. She is a woman that is nida. She is unclean. The blood flows. There's an issue that flows from her. There's an issue. We must understand what the issue is. She must be representative as to the cleansing process of this woman. She can't stay away from Yah 7 days and to be washed and to be cleansed. It cannot be. There must be a process according to Torah that refines her. Can I preach a little bit or teach? Which one? Teach? All right, I will teach then. I want you to go home full, all right? Okay. Hallelujah. May I draw your attention to Yirah, Leviticus chapter 15. Now there was a process that our Zacheni Ramiel taught us concerning the scapegoat. The goat or the offering of the sin of Yisrael. Leviticus chapter 15 and verse 1. I want to read this account because we tend to ostracize the bath of Tizayon. I tend to correct them. And we negate the whole of the picture, Yisrael. It says this in Leviticus chapter 15, verse 1. It says, and Almighty Yahweh, he spoke, he uttered from his voice. He spoke unto Moshe and to Haran, saying, this is what Yah says. Leviticus chapter 15, verse 1. This is what he said. He spoke unto Aharon and Moshe. He told him to speak to the children of Yisrael and say to them, I want you to hear this and see where he begins. He doesn't begin with a woman here. You understand? We have ignorant men that are unlearned men. They don't understand the power of Torah. He says this. He says, when a man has a running, a zub, same thing with a woman when she has a running. It is a zuba. When a man has a running, remember the word issue, all right? I'll define it as I go, of his flesh. You see where Yah begins here? He begins with the man. What running issue is that? Well, can I give an example of that? I will show you in scripture. It's a man, say he has no wife or he has no intimacy with the wife. And all of a sudden his mind began to think on some kind of relationship. And he finds himself, when he goes to relieve himself, he finds that there is an issue there. That's what that means, you understand? These are some stupid jackasses of men today. He says, so if a man has a zub, he has a flux, there is something that is running from him. That's what it says. I know what it says. You don't, but I know what it says. He says, if a man has an issue out of his flesh, because of his issue, he is unclean. He is tame. He's filthy. He is defiled. You all hear that? If a man has an issue. If a man has an issue of some kind of disease, but this word zub, it implies that there is a flux that comes forth out of the man's organ. If he finds himself with an issue, when he goes to relieve himself, he realizes that there's an issue. Yah says the man is unclean. And how many men have come before Yah's presence to lift up their hands and even their minds have been removed from Torah? These are stupid men. You need wise men to teach you, Yisrael. You all better hear me. This is what it says, doesn't it? That's why the man has allowed his guards to be let down. He said, if a man has this flux, there's a running and the issue. He says, the man is Tomei. He said, and this shall be his uncleanness, his tumah. He talks about the uncleanness. Listen, I search words out. Tumah is saying that his mind has been given over unto a sexual propensity for that moment, and he has arose from his natural organ, and that he find himself running. He's unclean. I know what I'm saying, my bad. I'm a student. Above all things, not a preacher or a teacher, I'm a student. We will never be able to come to the fullness of this truth. And I can appreciate men that are wiser than me. That's why I shut my mouth and listen to them. I don't care what the situation is. And this shall he be, or this shall be his uncleanness. The word tum'ah, it is a sexual thing he has played out in his mind. He has caused this zub, this running in his body. He has caused the release of flesh or liquids of flux to run down. Yah says the man is unclean. That's what the Torah says. The men will say, well, the woman is unclean. You're silly. Listen to this. He said he is unclean in his Isha. Remember the word Isha. Hold on to that word Isha. I-S-S-U-E-I-S-S-U-E-S. Maintain that. He said, whether his flesh run with his Isha or his flesh be stopped from his Isha, it is his uncleanness. It is his tum'ah. If a man has any kind of liquids that flow from his body, he is unclean. If a man has a sore like our Zachin Yeshurah and it flows, then Yah says he is unclean. That's what the Torah says. That is what the zub is. That's what the running. That's what the flux is, Yisrael. It is a nidah. And especially that which deals with the tumah, with a sexual appetite. I will, man. And then they sit before a woman or they encounter one. And then the thoughts are so vile. And then they find themselves, when they alleviate their ways from themselves, they find that there is something there that should not be there. I will, my friend. Yah says, by this Torah, they are unclean. Listen now. Every bed whereupon he lies, what he touches, that has the issue, it is unclean. So look at why he says, if he says in here, he says outside, it is unclean, Yisrael. It is unclean. You can squint your eyes on this, it's still the truth. You can try to figure it out, just hear it, you'll understand. It is unclean. And everything whereupon he sits, what he has thought that in his mind, he sits in your house, then your house is unclean, or that thing is unclean. He sits among you, it is unclean. It is, he sits, shall be to me, it shall be unclean. And whosoever touches bed shall wash his clothes. So with a man that has this issue, if I embrace one, then is that my purification process? If we're going to deal with what Torah says, you must wash your clothes. Isn't that so? Does that make a man clean because he washes clothes? Or have we perpetuated the tradition of the Hebrew Yisraelites, whereby we have denounced the power of the cleansing atonement of Yeshua HaMashiach? Now, if we go to buy all that I've already read, you must wash your clothes. So if a man touches a man, he knows that he has an issue. He says, don't touch me. If not, then you must wash your clothes. Hear me, Yisrael. He must wash his clothes and bathe himself just in water, not the living Torah, but he must bathe himself in water. It did not say soap, Leviticus 15:5. It's there in the book. Isn't it, you say, it's there. See, we want to take one aspect to prove that we are wise, and you're dumb as hell. He said he shall be unclean. He shall wash himself. And how many men have come into Yah's house with that kind of uncleanliness? And yet they will discuss, or they will say, I hear it from people. Because they want to try to cross me up to make them look well,
But they don't know they're dealing with the wrong man when they try to cross me up.
Do you grow the same kinds of seeds in the garden?
Well, I say, well, I grow turnips, and this is how you show you the ignorance. I grow collard greens and cabbages, and I grow Brussels sprouts and all of that together.
Well, can I say something to you, brother? You know you're not supposed to do that because it says in the Torah,
they don't even understand what the mixture of the zira is. They're stupid. I say to them, do you understand what the Baraska family of seeds are? Where do you buy your food? Where do you get your food? And you're going to try to correct me in Torah? Go to hell, man. I say, you understand what the Baraska family of seeds are?
Well, no, I don't understand.
Then shut your wicked mouth. You talk with ignorance. Let us conform our faces to the riches of Yah. When knowledge comes, let us make sure we are transformed. The Torah says this. Shurach says this. He says that the wisdom of a man shows in the countenance or the happiness of his face. Because he loves Torah. I'm going to teach on that soon. All right, Zachim. Hear this. Leviticus 15:5. And whosoever touches bed shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water, and he will be unclean until the evening. Will be a sad thing if Yeshua comes and say, your time is at hand. What does this niddah or this uncleanliness represent? Can I tell you, my Beth? There were traditional rituals of Torah, of ethical, and what we would call purifications. And yet they will cleanse themselves this moment and they were still unclean at the evening because the mind was not set in order to love Torah. That's what that was, Yisrael. And that's why Yahshua said, you transgress the Torah of Yah with your traditions of our forefathers. So the Pharisee said, I washed myself because I had a flux. So he appeared to be more righteous than the next man. So if this is my cleansing process, we all go into hell, all right? What do you say to the man there in Africa on that continent or somewhere where my water is not a premium? What do you tell him, you jackass? Yeah, you're a jackass. You're stupid. I don't care who you are. Don't try me. Don't write me those smart letters, all right? Prove me wrong in Torah. Listen, he shall be unclean until the evening. I would hate for Yeshua if I was unclean that morning. And trust that cleansing, without the cleansing, washing of the water of the Torah of Yah. Hear what it says. And he that sits upon anything whereupon he sat, that the Isha, don't forget the word Isha, shall wash his clothes and bathe himself with water, and he shall be unclean until the evening. Now, because I had a flux, and my friend Yosef come around and embrace me. Now he is unclean until the evening. He had no participation in the thoughts of my sin and to the wickedness of my sins. But according to the writing of the Torah, he is unclean. And so the only way he can cleanse himself, he must wash himself with the same water. Go to the creek and wash yourself and you're clean. Is that what he's implying? There's one. Keep your hands right there. And quickly to Ephesians. Stay right there in Leviticus. But I want to read this in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 6. So it says we must wash ourselves in water to be cleansed, to be purified, or tahor. And what was this process for? Who knows what this cleansing process was for? Most men don't know that, my Beth. They can speak, but they don't understand what this process was for. Can I tell you all, will you believe me? It was that you can offer the right offering, a zabach, unto Yah. That's why Yah said, I would that all men lift up clean hands everywhere. Like Shlomo did, he spread his hands to the heavens. That's what it is, Beth. This is not confusing, but we need those that have been drawn from the milk. They don't need to teach. Because line must be upon line, line upon line, precept, hill and there, little bath. I know what I'm saying. Listen, if I had wanted to, I could have been a college professor. And everyone would have sought to be in my class, too. Believe me. They would have all wanted to be in the class of Professor Yisrael. He's intriguing the way he teaches, the way he expresses things. They're so vivid and alive. Men get up here, they're dead. They have no animated character. I'm not here to be a damn clown, to have you some drama. I got a drama king here. He loves to show him. He's, look at me. Ouch, Poppy. He's the king of drama, not drama, drama. He hears me. Look what Shaul says here in Ephesians. Is this right? Is this true? Ephesians 5:26, that who, Almighty Yah in Yahshua, might set us, his nation, apart and cleanse it with the washing of the Mayim of the word, by the water by the word. That's how we're cleansed, by the washing of our filth by the word. It is the word that cleanses us. It is the word that purifies us. It was not the act of the deed. It was the discipline obedient unto that word that they were made clean, because this was the parameter that Yah operated upon. That's why we need this living word in us, Yahshua HaMashiach. He is the living Torah of Yah, and that is what cleanses us. Man having a flux, he has thought about some female counterpart. His mind has wavered into an area that he should not have been. And he finds himself with the Zub. He sits down among the elders. He touched them. And he doesn't have the courage to say that I have sinned and come before the altar. He's a damn coward. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you know you're going to defile me, you believe what I read in Leviticus, I'm glad that Yahshua is the living water. I'm glad once you wash in that water. That's why Kepha says, not only my feet, but wash me from the head down. That is what the immersing represents, a cleansing and a purifying of the nephesh. That's the whole life of us. What a beautiful thing. Our whole life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, do you hear that? That he might set us, the nation, apart. How? By the cleansing. It with the washing of the Mayim by the Torah. He washed us and he cleansed us by the Torah. Not dipping in a pool, not dipping in a basin of water. It is the power of that Torah that saturates us and cleanses us, that the Isha, don't forget the word Isha, I-S-S-U-E, Isha, that he may stop the flow. Only Yah can stop the flow. Only Yah can stop the flow of a man's mind that endeavors and he finds himself in the places whereby he should not mind, should not be. Only Yah can, same thing with the woman. She does the same thing. Her thoughts are on things and she finds herself with this Isha, and it ought not to be, Yisra'yah. Only Yah can stop that. And this is a damn hypocrite that has a standard of judge. I judge severely because, hell, I judge me with tenacity. I don't give a damn what one says. I judge me with fierceness. I take up whatever responsibility. Anything that fell around here, I take it on. My fault. Any sin is my fault. I'm not a coward. Say, well, somebody, who are they, them, it. Hell, who is it? My bag. And my days, we would say, my bag. My fault. My bag. Kill what it was. It falls on me. Everything that has transpired falls on me. Every kind of devious, unclean act that has been performed here, it's me. It's me. It's me. Not my brother nor my sister, but it's me, oh yeah. Filthy and unclean. Need the washing of the Mayim of your Torah, oh yeah. Wash me in Yeshua. Hallelujah. It's my fault. I'll take the responsibility. I don't mind. When the garden doesn't produce, it's my fault. I'm not on time. I was preoccupied by other things. I take it on. I don't have no problem taking upon. That's what a gubba does. I take it on. And I'm not a guilt. I am not a coward man. I say it's my fault. Well, they had it. Who in the hell is they? You including me. I didn't have it. I heard it here. Somebody moved it. Well, if you turn around, it's still right there. You just moved it there. That's the way we are. Hallelujah, I shall. Can I move a little farther and where Yirah 15:7? Turn back to Leviticus 15:7. Go back to 15:7. It says, then he that touched the flesh of him that has the issue shall wash his clothing, bathe himself in water, and he is unclean until evening. He is unclean until evening. And there are those that try to perform these works of righteousness. But I'm reminded of what Shaul says to Titus, in the application of truth. He speaks so profoundly in Titus chapter 3, verse 5. Titus chapter 3, verse 5. Hold on to Leviticus. I'm reading out of what we call the Torah. And the Torah are the first five books of the writings, right? But this is the Torah. This book, the word Torah, is the wisdom of life. It is what administers life. And so the whole book administers life to me. The whole book. Look what Shaul says in Titus chapter 3, verse 5. He says, not by works of tzaddik, of righteousness, which we have done. It's not what works we have done. It's not by your washing. It's not how you wash yourself. It's not how you cleanse yourself from that issue. Because I want you to remember the word issue. You still have an issue. It's not about works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his raham, or his raham, according to his mercies, according to his tzaddik, according to his character, he delivered us. This is what delivered us. It is the mercies of God that delivers us. It is the compassion of God that delivers us. In all of our ignorance, that's what delivers us. Yeah. Titus 3:5. It's according to his rohing, his mercies, he delivered us. How? By the washing. By the washing. By washing us. But I touch my up, but Yahshua has washed you. I sit down where he sat, but Yahshua has washed you. By the washing of regeneration, the birth of the knowledge, regeneration is to bring forth new growth. That's what, to bring forth the new growth of the wisdom of Torah, the knowledge of Torah, by the regeneration and the renewing. And the renewing are to cause the Ruach to stand up and show you where you are. The renewing of the Ruach HaKodesh, that's how we're cleansed. I'm glad I don't have to depend on no pot going over that washing. I'm glad you bath. I'm glad you are, that you have had your struggles. I have as well. We all have had them. I'm glad when the issue flows, you don't have to go to a pot and come tell everybody, I got an issue. It's been flowing. And they tell everybody else. I'm glad you daughters of Tizayon don't announce some of my ministries, and I got that. I'm crapping. I'm this. Shut your damn mouth. That's why there's so many foolish doctrines, tradition, and stupid men make other stupid men even more stupid. It's all right to be ignorant, but a stupid man, he's a beast, and a stupid woman is a beast. I'd rather be ignorant than to be stupid. Because an ignorant man will learn. We were all, one time we all walked in our ignorance. Not in our stupidity. We walked in ignorance. That's not enough, preach. I know it's not enough, but I'm finished. Get this thing right for us. So you don't write me, okay? You will never have to write me and talk about this again. You get knowledge of it. Hallelujah. Now look at verse 8 of the same 15th chapter. It says, and if he that has the issue, Leviticus 15 verse 8. So if a man has this issue, this flow, this sexual, this tumah, he has this thing that flows from him. If a man has this issue, spit or rocha, upon him that is clean, then he shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water, and he is unclean to evening. So if a man, if you're talking to him and you say, oh man, you spit on me. A little drop of spit, most of the times you won't even tell him. So you don't even know you are unclean because just a little spittle has fallen upon you. Ah, yeah. And you think you justify yourself by the process of purification. It is Yeshua, it is Yah that justifies us by his process. By the washing and the renewing, the regeneration of our mind, by the Ruach HaKodesh. It says not only that, and what saddle soever, he's talking about those things. If he rides in on a saddle of an ass, well, that's not equating to my condition. So if he sits in a car, you get out, you sit in that spot, you're unclean. That's all that is saying, man. And so you think that men are going to tell someone that I have an issue? He's not supposed to. He has an issue, but it's not this issue that has made him unclean. I will show you the issue, Yisrael. So if a man sits on an ass and he has a flux in his body, he has a nida, and a brother come and sit in the same seat, and that brother's unclean. And if you don't tell him, if he dies before that evening, he goes to hell. He's talking about a process ceremoniously that Yeshua HaMashiach, in that body, he took away, he destroyed. I'll teach on that. I'll show us. These ignorant men, they don't know. I'll show us, all right? You'll be able to hear me, all right? I'll teach you. I got a message. I don't know. It's about 10 pages on that. I was putting together a message this morning when I began to see the writing of Torah. No, I get up on Shabbat too, like I do during the week. I get up late on the Shabbat, between 7 and 7:30. During the week, I get up early, between 4:45. Maybe 5:15 when I'm lazy. I like to get up. It energizes me. It gives me strength. I can carry out my day of labor. I don't like to sleep. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little falling of hand, then poverty come. You forget who you are. I like to get up. I like to rise up early. It's the early bird that gets the worm, right? Ah! So I want the truth. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Listen now in verse 10. Whosoever touches or naga, anything. Does it say anything? Whosoever touches anything that was under him shall be unclean until the evening. So you tell me you got this issue. You go out, you touch something that someone else touched, and you don't have the audacity to say that I touched that. It's unclean. You'll be unclean till this evening. People look at you and say, go to hell, you silly boy. That's what Torah says. I'll read it again. And whosoever touch anything, whosoever naga, anything that was under him shall be unclean until the evening. And he that bears any of those things shall wash his clothing and bathe himself in water. And he shall be unclean until evening. So here you sit in the seat and the little baby comes along. The little baby is unclean. I'm going to make it clear for you, Yisrael. Don't worry. You got to understand what all of this is prophetically about. It is the Naba. The Naba is the utterance. That's why we sing, let everything that hath breath praise Yah. So that's what Naba is. It is the causing, it calls one to sing and to play the timbrel and they shout in the news of the tough news of the truth of Yah. So anyone that touch anything, we're talking about the man, are we not? We're not talking about the woman. We're talking about the man. When men don't have issues, then Yah is a law then. So someone like our Yeshuram, you can't even touch him. How do you lay hands on him or anoint him with oil? This is how damn stupid this world is. This is how silly you are, how immature, how unlearned you are. You don't know a damn thing. Be quiet and you'll learn. Yeah, I'm going to talk like this. I don't care if you don't like it. That's how stupid this world is. They don't know how to talk. They just ramble and ramble on. The Torah tells us, even when a wise man speaks, just be quiet. Just hold your words. There are men today that they hear wise men talk, they got to interject their stupidity and their immaturity. I don't care what the matter is. When I talk, I know what I'm talking about, all right? Just be quiet. Listen to me. Well, I know how to build. I can build too. I can build as well as you. I just don't do it. Because I know you can do it as well as me. That's right, mama. Ain't nothing I can't do if I want to. Nothing. I can do all things through Yeshua HaMashiach that strengthens me. So he shall wash his clothes, he shall be unclean to this evening, verse 11. And whosoever he shall touch that has the issue. Again, the word issue, I want you to remember that, Yisrael. Remember the word zu, Zub Bishop, and has not rinsed his hands in water. You tell me that's cleansed my nephesh? What is this alluding to? What is this implying? You don't rinse your hand in water and shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water and be unclean until the evening. And the vessels of earth that he touched, which he has issued, shall be broken. So when there's an ark that comes into the dining hall or eat among us and he has this issue, you take everything that he has touched, you tell him, you throw it out. But Yah said the vessel shall be broken. You see the ignorance of men, how they deny all of this. And they get one little thing and they think they're wise. That's how stupid men are. They're boys. They are naha. Naha. They're young. They're juvenile. I was talking to my Zachin Tayonia yesterday. I said, my Ak. I said, everything I have learned, the foundation and the premises, I said, I had a great teacher, and I shut my mouth. And yet he doesn't even understand the things that I understand now, because he gave me a tremendous foundation. He can't search it out like I do, and he's in his 70s now. I would never disregard him or talk over him or disrespect, although he talked crazy. He told me the name 33 years ago, 34 years ago. He didn't keep it. He didn't keep the Shabbat. Yah separated me to begin the process of keeping the Shabbat and moving from that. As I learned how to listen, and I loved him greatly, I would take the shoes off of my feet for him. That's the honest truth, man. I would give every dime. My electricity turned off. No gas. I had to walk to work. I wasn't ashamed because I love what he taught me. I love what came out of that man. And when he would ask me questions, I would show him how ignorant I was. I never answered. I was quiet. Well, that means that you're a silly man. I know you don't know the answer. Because you have not been quick to hear. You've been quick to speak, but you have not been quick to hear and slow to speak. Moving quickly. I'm going to finish this today. I want to move quickly. It says that now here all these people are unclean. Let me drop down to verse 13 because there's something I want to get to that's vital. When you're about 15, 13. And when he that has an issue is tocher, when one, verse 13, when he is clean of his issue, this is what he must do. So when you're a clean man at that evening, then he shall number to himself 7 days for his cleansing. How many men do that? How many of those that say the Hebrew Israelites do that? How many of them have flux and runs that do this? He shall separate himself for 7 days for the cleansing, and he shall wash his clothes, and he shall bathe his flesh in running water, and he shall be clean. That's what it says. He shall number himself. He shall beat himself 7 days. Yahshua is the perfect order of Torah. He is the perfect composition of Torah. He is the perfect composition. The numerics are seven, and one day I'm going to teach on all the numerics. I know how to. The numerology of Torah. He shall beat himself for 7 days and he shall be cleaned. I'm in trouble then. Because if I have to wait 7 days for my wickedness and my corruption, woe unto me. Where is my scapegoat? I will. Where are the ashes of the heifer to be sprinkled on you? You see how they, with their traditions of their stupidity and their unlearned ways, they put heavy burdens on the people. They don't say Yahshua is sufficient. She's uncleansed, but she's been cleansed by the dam. He's unclean, but he's been cleansed by the dam. Yeah. Cleansed from what? Not just from the flood, but from the issue of his own mind, Yisrael. Yeah. That's what he's been cleansed from. Yeah. He's been washed. His mind has been purged and washed. Yeah. And so they take upon traditions and teachings that have no relevance in the form that they think that they know. And they try to impress each other. You can't impress me with that. Don't write me. Don't write me with that bull. You don't know. You have no understanding. And you play that on those that is as ignorant as you. That's why you go to those that are ignorant as you. You will not confront one like me. When they confront me, I have them to hang up. I do. Well, it seems like you are kind of, your voice seems so, I says, because I'm tenacious. I'm a lion. When the area roars, you hear him. When a lion roars, you can hear him up to 5 miles. I said, that's why I talk like that. Well, it seems like me that you're angry. I say, what's wrong with being angry? Y'all's angry with the wicked every day. Did you understand that? Are you still there? Are you still there? Coward. They crank it down on me all the time. I don't care. Because I don't want them wasting my time. I'd rather be in the bean field picking beans. I got to hit the fields early in the morning. Get some tomatoes out. Get some okra out. I got to plant in the morning. So don't call me in the morning. Don't call me. Hallelujah. And this is what it says here now in Leviticus 15:14. Does it say this in your book? And on the eighth day, he shall take to him 2 turtle doves. Where are your turtle doves, man? Men are stupid. They are stupid as not even a jackass. But the proper form of donkey. See, even the jackass knows his master's crib. But my people know not me. But this is what the Torah said. You want to take one of those verses and teach. Now, let's read the entirety of it. He shall bring before him 2 turtle doves. On the eighth day, 2 turtle doves, 2 young pigeons. And come before Yah at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation and give them to the Kohan. That's what he must do. That's what he must do. Because he has a flux. He's guilty of a sin in his mind that is so vile that he has lost control of his flux. He must bring 2 turtle doves, 2 pigeons, bring it to the Kohan, and the Kohan shall offer them. Oh, so it needs the burnt offering now. Sure, it needs the burnt offering. Same offering. It needs the holocaust, the whole burnt offering, the fullness of the burnt offering. But let me explain it to you. Let me show you that burnt offering. Sure, yeah, the word is still the same today as it was then. But this is a spiritual dynamic that it takes spiritual men to understand. Sensual men don't understand. He says, and the Kohan shall offer them, and one for the sin offering. So the death of Yahshua has no right. We have no heritage in that. One for the sin offering, and the other for the burnt offering. And the Kohan shall make a kaffah, an atonement for him before Yah. For what? His what? His issue. Don't forget the word issue. For his issue. So is that how we stop the issue? 2 turtle doves? 2 pigeons? You bring them before the Kohan, before the messenger for sin offering? I'm not going to offer it for you. I had one to write me recently and said, Rayak, I'm having problem with pornography, with this and all of that. Young man. And so he writes me the other day, did you get my email? I said, I responded. And all you need to do is cleanse your damn filthiness of your flesh and your ruach and the sight of your. Cleanse yourself. You can cleanse yourself from that. Cleanse yourself from this damn vile nature. And stop doing it, man. And the man just recently said a nice offering. I'm not going to pacify him. Stop it. Stop it. You have the power to stop that. I'm not going to pray for that. Yah, let your hammer come on him. Oh, don't pray that. Just stop it, man. I say, man, stop that. You have the power to stop that. You have the ability to stop that. You have the strength. You can cleanse yourself. That's why he commanded, cleanse yourself from all filthiness. Of the flesh and the ruach and perfect, make yourself complete. How by studying the Torah and hearing what the Torah says, and perfect that which is pure in the sight of Yah. You got to have some fear. You don't have no fear. You're watching some damn whores, and you're a faggot for watching that. You're a damn faggot for watching it. You get excited over that. You're sick in your damn mind. You go sick over women with women. And you are damn faggot. Just like the damn faggot of the day. That the world is just, oh, Jason Collins. He's a damn punk. Damn Jason Collins. Damn faggot dog. Mr. Obama, this grinning chestnut. Hey, Jason. Miss Obama, I'm saddened by your wicked ways, woman. Jason Collins is a beautiful fact. He's a damn 6'10", a damn monstrous of a man. It's retarded. That's what he graduated from Sanford, where Tiger Woods went. Made Tiger Woods a whoremonger and made him a faggot. I'd rather sit down at the councils of the Zachin before Yah. At least they will say, get that damn spirit ball for you. You're mine. take a stick to his arse. And they rejoice in that. That's why David said, I will praise you with all my heart before the gods. You and your God are going to hell, Jason Collins. Mr. Obama, you strengthen the hands of that wicked boy and you say you're a Christian. I buy it. You are a fag Christian, that because the Christian house are full with faggots. It's full with bulldaggers. TDJ's got enough faggots in there to start a city. Creflo Dollar got enough faggots. And down here in Atlanta, we got the fag daddy dog, Mr. Bishop Long, the big daddy fag stick. And I call them faggots. You dislike it, have them to take it down. I don't give a damn. You promote this kind of wickedness to your sons. He's a basketball player. He's a homosexual. See, he's a damn freak. He's a dog. There's no such word as a homosexual. You gave a man a right mind to desire woman. And when a man doesn't desire woman, he's a damn freak. It's all right. I had them to say they were eunuchs. And all of a sudden they become wanton. That's what the Torah says. Gotta have a woman. Then they lose the status of a eunuch now. That's a damn lie. You were never committed. You were never real. You were phony. You were false. And you took upon approach to make yourself look big. That's why they do that. I don't care if you don't like me. And so they promote this faggot dog. So they got these faggot ball players. That's right, Jason. You're straight, baby. I don't want to be around a faggot. I'm not going to be around a faggot. I don't want no faggot. I don't even want to. When I find faggots in the stores, I don't even want them. I don't say nothing. Get away from me, man. Bulldagger woman, you act like a bulldagger. You act like a dog. Your mind is so damn twisted, you don't know you're a woman. Look, you got titties, woman. I don't care if they're fat or little. You got titties. You got the plumbing of a woman. You don't have the plumbing of a man. Bisexual. No such damn thing as bisexual. He gave the veracity of a man to be drawn to a woman and a woman to be drawn to a man. Something twists in your damn mind. You want to be drawn to another man. And this is what I said I wasn't going to talk about it. Yeah, but this is what they're promoting to our children, though. They're infusing this in your baby's mind, Yisrael. You have to be careful with these damn crazy games and all that. They're infusing this, that damn television. You have to be careful. They're putting that in your baby. They got faggot. They got faggot show. They got faggot reality show. I know they have it. I don't even know what's on television, but I know they got that. And people watch. Oh, look at them faggots. And all of a sudden, your son began to feel, oh, mama, because he's acting like Faggot John on television. That's none of y'all. He never promoted anything like that. He promoted a man and a woman. He didn't give Adam some kind of faggot ass pig of a dog. He gave him Chava. He gave him a woman to be his helpmeet, to be the beauty of his strength. I don't want a woman that can't be the beauty of my strength. When I talk, I want her to reflect that. I want her to reflect what she knows that I am. And I don't want to be a damn hypocrite because I live with her. She knows me better than anyone. I say one thing and I do it differently. I went way in there. No, I don't want that. That's why we need Gabba. We need strong men, not these little weasel, weak back boys. Hell, the old men are stupid today. You can't find them that are wise. I like your Ruach, man. I do. There are not many men that I like their Ruach. I don't like many men. Ruach. Y'all get quiet. Why not me? Because from day one, in all of his rejection, he has never been a damn hypocrite and phony. You got the real deal with him. That's why I like men like that. I'd rather know the real deal than a damn phony pretender. And he knew I wasn't no phony pretender. That he knew. Because he feared to say, Mama, you go when you want to. Here's a little offering. Here's your tithe pad. And fight his wife. And I didn't say a damn thing to him. Didn't try to show him what I knew, did I? See, fools, and then you find those that he was trying to show you what they knew. Well, brother, you need to do that. Like, man, just shut your damn mouth. I'm right. I'm real. Hallelujah. Let me read. I want to finish this today. I shall, my friend. Leviticus chapter 15, verse. It talks about the burnt offerings that made the atonement. Verse 16, quickly. And if any man's seed, now look at this now. If any man's seed of copulation go shechaba, He loses that. Why are you entertaining? Leviticus 15, 16. Out from him. Now this is what this, what does the word copulation mean? You understand what that means. We won't express it in a dramatic way, but we understand what it means. We that of a mature mind. When he goes, shechabah, from out of him, then he shall wash his flesh in water, and he shall be unclean till evening. Then those at the midnight, they're in trouble then. And they get up and touch other men. They touch others. They go to their jobs. Those that give you your change, they say, here's your change. Here's your money. You touch them. You touch their hands. You touch anything that they have touched, Yisrael. There are things that we should not touch. One of the main things, Yah tell us to touch not the unclean things of the world. The nidah, that's what we touch. Not that. Don't touch it in our minds. Give ourselves over unto that. Because I touch a brother that's in that situation or have experienced that or and a whole, that doesn't mean I'm filthy because of that. Silly men that have no knowledge of Torah. Quit trying to impress each other. That's what's wrong. That's why you got everybody on the court. I watch as someone subscribed to YouTube. Two men out there. There was a group on each side, called themselves Hebrew Israelites. And one found something on one that he could denounce him and pronounce against him. He had tattoos. He said, man, I got that before I even knew you. He said, well, take it off. And they were ready to throw him. I said, look at these ignorant jackasses of boys. And the one that this young boy was rebuking, he wouldn't shake his hand. And this big 6'2" cat, all these big monsters. No, get away from him. That's these cowards. You'd be surprised what's out there. And they look for the gullible and the insecure and those not assured. That's why men are always trying to impress upon someone that they got something. Hell, your life speaks for you. When I go places, I don't talk, but I speak. I told y'all the scenario of that young boy. He was looking to say, mama, that's a man right there. That's the kind of man I need in my life. That's what he was saying. When he was looking at me, he was looking at mama, he looked at me, he looked at mama. And he looked at me with such passion in his eyes. You understand? When I see people like that, and then I look in a way that, you're right, son. And that's what he was saying. He looked at me, and he just held his eyes on me. Then he looked at his mother. Then he looks at me. He looks at his mama. He looks at me. He looks at his mama, and when he turned his head back, I didn't want him to feel a sense of uncomfortability with me. What he was saying when he was looking at mama, this is a man right here. This is the kind of man I would love in my house. I can see his wisdom. I can see his beauty of strength. I can see his understanding. That's what he said. He spoke to me. See, I'm wise. He that is spiritual judge all things. He judges of no man. See, that's what this young lad, his words, his eyes spoke for. Can you tell something in the eyes of people? Can't you look at their eyes and tell? Come on, you bathroom. You look at your man to tell him you love him. Come on. It's not the verbiage. It's your eyes. Get the damn hardness out of you. Come on, man. That's what we need. And that's what that young lad spoke to me. He said, he was saying, man, mama, this would be such a great thing if I had somebody like him. Wow. Look at this man. And he was hoping his mama, look, I'm a silly woman. You in the store walking like that. Woman, stop it. You're mincing. You're trying to draw attention. Just walk. Miss Mickle taught the young girls how to walk when I was in school. She taught them. You walk in my segregated school. She taught us, the girls, how to walk. And they would laugh. Miss Pickles was a robust woman. She was, never forget how she looked. Very classy dresser, kind of shoes to wear, heels, but like that big wide heel. And she would teach them. She said, walk, girls. And we boys liked that because it was funny to us. She taught them how to walk. Don't they teach the pages how to walk? Okay. So Yah teaches us how to walk. I don't care if I'm crippled, I'm going to still walk with strength. I don't care if I'm still. I watch my Ishael sometimes. She can get that thing more. You don't know nothing, man. She just get the, she get the rolling. Me, not that step. Fools will not like what I'm saying. You that are wise, you will love me for this, all right? Can I move a little farther? Hallelujah. One more verse here in verse 17, and then I want to show us something. Keep Leviticus, all right? It says this, and every garment, Leviticus 15, 17, and every garment and every skin whereupon its seed of copulation shall be washed with water and be unclean till evening. So the bed that he rests upon with his ishal or whatever, that is unclean. So they both are unclean. They both are unclean until the evening according to Torah. What Yah has cleansed, let no man, no, you don't eat swine. Let no man call it coming. We have been cleansed and washed in the dam of Yahshua HaMashiach. Even their traditions and the way they performed it, it was wrong, Yisrael. So he gave us the perfect adjudication of the Torah and the dam of Yahshua HaMashiach. Let me give you some inspiration here. Turn quickly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me show you quickly here in the book of Mishli Proverbs. We're still talking about the issue, all right? This Zub, okay? Now look what Yah says in Proverbs 4:23. Keep your hands there in Leviticus. We're going back. I want you to hear this in Proverbs Mishli 4:23. Yah commands us to keep our law with all mishmah, with all diligence. When Yah says all diligence, he means that you imprison yourself. You cause your heart to be so captivated. You post of guard. You post the Ruach HaKodesh. Keep yourself with all mishmah, with all diligence, with all diligence, with all diligence. He tells us to do with all diligence. That we confine ourselves. We imprison our hearts. We don't let it think outside of the parameter of the Torah. So we keep ourselves that way within the parameter of the Torah. When you do it diligently, there's observation. You watch. There's perspective. And you don't go beyond the law of that order. So we must do it all diligently. Why must we do that? Why? This is the answer here. Don't forget the word Isha. For out of it are the issues of life. Does it say that? If a man has an Isha. If a man has an Isha. We're going to get to the woman. But if a man has an Isha, out of the heart flows what? The issues of life. The issues of life. How many times have I repeated that word today? Quite a few times, haven't I not? So I told us to remember the word Isha. Remember the word issue, for out of the heart flows the issue of life. If a man has a flux that flow out of him, he's unclean. And those that touch him, notice when you eat from the uncleanliness out of the issue, out of a man's heart, you become unclean. But that gives us no clarification. Well, let's see what Yahshua says. Let's see what the Torah says. Matthew 15:18. Hold on to Leviticus. Because I want to show you this minister woman. She cannot come into the house of Yah. Matthew 15:18. It says, but those things which proceed out of the mouth come forth from where? The heart. Did it not? Shaul says, for out of the heart flows the issue, the zub, this unclean thing. He says, for out of the issues of life. He said, and that's what defiles a man. That's what makes him tuma. That's what makes him unclean. What comes out of heart? For out of the heart, out of the left proceed evil thoughts. You've never had an evil thought, huh? That's the issue. You need to get right with your Akka, your Hota. You got this damnable evil thought against them. You're a damn bulldog. You got this Nahash, and you don't have the damn courage to tell them. Not the flux because of the sin of your thought. He said, evil thoughts, and you are a murderer. You hate your brother without a cause. You hate your sister, but you love the damn wicked. You're happy to see the wicked. But you're not happy to see your hope in the morning. You're not happy to see your uck. You're waking with a damn ugly frown on your face that is so hideous and wicked. You don't check yourself. Is this making sense? All right. See, out of the heart flows the issues of life. What are the issues? What are the things that you better get some dom on you? You better get some washing. You touch an unclean man because he's unclean. I see a wine head on the street. He got a flux. I pick him up. I'm unclean. You are silly as hell. You see a woman that has been hit. She's on administration. You pick her up. She's unclean. You unclean. That's so damn dumb. That's not what this, even the metaphor, the figurative, the actuality, the reality of that. That's not what Yah was implying. We're dealing with a damn stupid mind. They cannot understand the talk of the spirituality of things. And the same thing today. We don't understand the spiritual things. He was talking to a damn mind that replicated sin and darkness. That was his enemy. That's why we have the mind of Yahshua. And these damn dumb fools today talk with the same kind of mind. I like this preacher man. He talks right. I have to love me in order to love you. I'm not angry at you because I'm not angry at me. And so I will show you my expression. I may not talk to you, but I talk to you, all right? You do enough talking to me, just being quiet, you precious Baptist. I like to chit-chat with women. Never have. Not even in the world I chit-chatted. When I chit-chatted with women, it was for devious purpose. When I chit-chatted with women, it was for devious purpose. When I chit-chatted with women, it was for devious purpose. When I chit-chatted with women, it was for devious purpose. And you find yourself in your own way, it's some kind of flirtation, although you know it, that's not right. You find yourself presenting yourself, look at me, woman. I'm fine. You're not fine, man. You look silly. You stink. Your body stink. You think you're that fine. You think you're the finest thing on earth. You silly boy. Little boy think he's handsome. Come on. I'm not trying to look handsome for the world. I want to be right in the sight of Yah. I want him to say, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. He was talking to a people that hell, when he brought them out, they could not understand the reality of that. They go and build some damn golden calves. He talked to a people today that is so damn dumb. Instead of adhering to the cleansing of the dam of Yahshua, it took the blood of the pigeon. It still takes the blood. These men today are too damn dumb. They can't even see their ways. And you too as well, my Bath of Zion. Don't write me telling me I'm hard on the women. I treat the women here wrong. I got a beautiful wife. She's a strength unto me. Hallelujah. I know how to treat a wife. Hell, that's why you don't have a husband. You got a boy. Keep quiet, huh? Listen to this. For out of the left did not Shlomo say, for out of the heart flows the issue of life. Don't forget the word issue, all right? This to say, the things that come forth out of you. Yahshua says in Matthew 15 and verse 19, for out of the left proceed evil thoughts, murder, adultery, and fornication. Well, I haven't touched no woman. If a man looks upon a woman to desire her, he's committed adultery and fornication already in his mind. So, man, you tell me you now have looked on a woman, you got that flux running out of you. See, that's the issue. That's what's running out of you, man. That's what's running out of you, woman. This is what Yahshua comes to. This is what the Torah deals with. It is not the actuality as much as you touching an unclean woman's clothing. That's not the issue. You look on that woman, hell, you remember on your bed, you think about that, you find yourself with an issue. And you want to get all damn spiritual and say, well, a woman that's on her period, she ought not come into the house of Yah. You silly boy. And that's how these immature men talk, because they don't understand the depths of Torah. So they find those that are as weak and immature as those. They are. Wise men, he just listened to men that are wise. If you don't know him wise, then go to hell. Find you someone that's wise. He said, these are the things that come out. Adultery, fornication. They're thieves. They steal. They hear what someone else says and they repeat it without knowledge of it. And they try to put that on someone else, that they are the orchestrator of that wisdom. He said, they are false witnesses. They witness against Torah in their falseness, and they are blasphemer. He says, these are the things which defile a man. But not what one eat with unwashed hands that defile a man. So you tell me, if I touch my ox that has a flow and a flux, if I touch him, I'm unclean, I'm defiled. That's not what it is. What I read in the beginning. Let me read this. I use the word ochel. Ochel. Let me go back here. Just listen to it. I want you to hear this. Hallelujah. It says this. Let me find that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It says in Lamentation, just stay right there in Shemoth, don't turn. But it says in Lamentation, I read this. Yisrael, Yerushalayim, I call for my lover, but they deceived me. He said, my Kohanim and my elders gave up the nefesh. They gave up the power of the life. Why? Because they sought their own ochel. They sought their own meat. They were trying to figure how to feed their own damn bellies. They lay on their bed and try to figure how to satisfy their lusts, what they wanted, what they desire. They're not trying to feed the people of Yah. Trying to look smarter than someone. I don't want to look smarter than no one. I worked with young men from when I worked at IBM. And they were always apologetic to me. And the basically 99.999% of them were Caucasian men. They were engineers. And they honored my proudness, my knowledge about things, because I stayed sharp for them. And so they would say to me, you need to go back. Go ahead and get your degree. I said, damn, a degree. I don't want no degree. I don't want to go back to college. David, your calling is life. I remember this young man telling me, he was an engineer. He was on his way to the war college. He was going to become a lieutenant. He says to me, you have beautiful skills of counseling. You're a counselor. You're a man that has the ability to counsel, to instruct, to bring forth essence of knowledge. He went to college to learn how to kill folks. You understand? But I would say this to them. I would say to them, they would say to me, my education means nothing. I say, that's not the truth. I say, it took a tenacity, a proudness, a strength, a fortitude. I said, you downplaying that for me? I don't need you to do it. And they would turn beet red because they were scared, because I'm big then. 240 pounds, big arm, small waist, and a big chest. And so when I walked, everybody looked. I said, it's not so, my friend. And because I had the audacity to speak like that, they would say, come to my office, come on. Whether they were Jew, white, it made no difference. They talk with me. O.J. Miller, he graduated from Carnegie Mellon and Princeton. That's an education, isn't it? Come talk to me. Let's sit down. And he would, with his little analytical ways and his little preciseness of his engineering concepts, talk to me. And I would be bold as a lion. I would break him down like you break down a matchstick. Sure I would. And they respected me. I demanded that. Man of character, you're going to respect him? No, you're going to respect him. I go to the hood and fellas will look at me and they'll just look. They're not going to mess with me because I'm not going to mess with them. I don't have to worry about them. I'm not going to mess with them. I'm straight. How's everything, man? That's how. They're not going to mess with me. I'm not going to cause them no trouble. And they're not going to cause them any. That's a fact. That's a fact. I know who I am. You just don't know who I am. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So these are the things that defile a man who flows from his heart. This is what? The issue. Well, that does not identify us. Can I go back to Yirah, Leviticus chapter 15, verse 18? I want to read this because I want to finish. You all say, Yah, help him to finish. Oh, this is beautiful here. I like this. Let me move a little quicker on this. Leviticus 15, 18. Now it begins to talk about the woman. Is all this in the same chapter? How do men forget this about men and they just talk about the woman? They're stupid as hell. And if it's you, you're stupid. I'm an equal opportunist in Torah. It's all equal. It is. In order for the wife to submit to all her husband says, he got to learn how to love her. He got to learn how to love her. And love her right. It's not the bad thing. Hell, if that was the bad thing, then you would be satisfied. It's not the bad thing. But like if a woman is that big, like if she's that big, or she's that big, it's all the same. I don't care what color skin is. It's all the same thing. It causes one reaction to each action. And the reactions are the same. Has nothing to do with that. And so the harb of Yah is greater than some kind of celebration of that moment, but the great power of his love will bring about a climactic event of that celebration when a man learns how to love. Men want wives just to have some kind of copulation. These are stupid men, even old men and young. That shouldn't be the purpose of a wife. If you never touch her, that is right, old woman. A woman like this with a husband, what is he going to do? I mean, get some Viagra, get real. So woman, all these years she's been with me, no man has, they've tried, kept the devils back. So aren't you glad? Sure I have. All these years she's been with me. She's a Beth, not a Beth Ula, but a Chayil, virtuous woman. And all these old fools want to just say, man, that's not it. That's not it. When a man learns how to love, the only way I can... My love is sure with her. I got to know how to love him and him and him. And they see that in my expression. We get together, they say, we work together. It's not some type of damn moody attitude. I don't have that. I don't have that. I'm not up and down and up and down. You're twisted. You're sick in your damn immature mind. You're sick. You get mad about the least little thing. The Torah tells us that anger, the af of a man, it rests in the bosom of a damn fool. No one else. So if I'm working with my young, just a few of us, I don't care those that have been here, or I may say, let's go, man. Come on, yo, sippy, I'll pick it up, baby. I talk like that out there. Come on, big daddy. Let's move, sure. Come on, man. because I'm coming on right along with them. Don't talk like that to him, though. Yeah, I talk like that to him. Come on, shimmery man. Come on, man. That's all you cut, man. I talk like that. But I don't talk from a conscience of stupidity and anger and moodiness. And so we can meet in our little office over there, and we can walk together and brace each other. How you doing, man? Always concerned about him. How you doing, man? I can tell when his day is tough. I can tell when he's had a tough day. So how you doing, my friend? You know I'm all right, Ray. Yeah, I know you're all right, but I want to make sure you're all right. Come on, man. Ain't about no damn money thing with us. Ain't about no damn money thing. Damn money. Damn it all. Damn your pennies. You think you're giving something here. Ain't about no money with him. He knows that. It's about a genuine care and a love that's real. And when you love him, it's because I love me. If I'm damn moody and mad, I'm mad at me. You're a stupid jackass of a woman, and you're a silly damn boy. You're not even, forgive me, Achashner. Forgive me, my friend, Abner, and Achlevlin, and Melchaya. What's his name, Melchaya? Yes, Melchaya. Forgive me. You don't even constitute that. See it in your face, your expression, grow up. I'm talking to you. Hallelujah. You bless me, Ema Sabea. You're getting old woman. Been with me a long, long time. Make sure that you go the way of our forefathers, Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, right? We bury you if you don't bury me first. That's right. Can I proceed a little further? Okay, it says here in Leviticus 15:18, the woman also with whom a man shall lie with seed of copulation, they shall both bathe themselves in water and be unclean till the evening. That's what Torah said. They shall both be unclean. Your wife. So we understand the identity of copulation, all right? I'll leave it from that. But this is the catalyst here verse 19. And if a woman have an issue, it is called zub. A flow, a flux, a nidah, her period. If she has a zub and her issue is in her flesh, be blood, be dam, she shall be put away 7 days, and whosoever touch her shall be unclean until the evening. So her little baby, she got to suck her titty. He's got to suck the titty. So the baby's unclean till the evening. He's talking to a man. What was Yah trying to say to us? That I want you to become so disciplined to the adherence of Torah above all things. This is what he says in the renewed covenant. The first commandment is what? Shemach kol Yisrael, lo ichad. Pure Yisrael, Yah is one. That's all he was trying to get them to understand, Yisrael. And because he was speaking with a boyish mind, they couldn't understand. He brought them out, they held, they made a god. And they rose up to play copulation and everything. Didn't have no damn shame in the wilderness. Babies there, they didn't have no damn shame. A whore has no shame. Can I move a little farther? So if her issue of her flesh be blood, so shall she be put away 7 days. Whosoever touches her shall be unclean. Verse 20. And everything that lies upon her in separation, the word separation is nidah. It is unclean. In separation. Shall be unclean. And everything that sit upon the same shall be unclean. And whosoever touch a bed shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water. That's all right, praise it. And be unclean until evening. Whosoever touch anything that sat upon shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water until the evening. Is not this the same stipulation for a man? Is it identical? Is it parallel? So we as men, we must deal with us first. In order to deal with our inabilities and our shortcomings, that's how we strengthen the woman, because it's just by a pattern of example. Yeah. Same stipulations. And if it be on her bed or anything whereupon she sits, when we touch it, it shall be unclean unto the evening. Listen to this. And if any man lie with her at all, and her flowers be upon him, he shall be unclean for 7 days. So if a man lie with his woman that has an issue, if he touch her during that time, he's got to be unclean 7 days. We don't even understand that we are in the seventh day. And Yeshua has cleansed. That's right. You're ignorant. You don't understand. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. This is the menorah, isn't it? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. What does the 7 days represent? He couldn't talk to them that way. That's why I can't. You know, there are things that I can't preach. Yeshua said, I got many things to tell you, but you're not able to bear them. That seven means the seven ruachim. Until the power of the ruach, until the seven ruachim, until the spirit of Yah endow you, you rise up from the issue of your ma and say he is great. That's what that means. 7 days, seven ruachim of Yah, the seven spirits of Yah. This is a stupid word. It makes me angry. I get angry when I see people teaching. Is this hard to understand, my bad? You, is this hard? Do you understand what I'm saying? You do too? No, not Mr. Drama King. He does. He looked at me like, preach, preach. See, he said, now go ahead, Rhea. He shall be unclean 7 days. I don't care what a man's sin is until he get the fear of Yah in him, the ruach of understanding, wisdom. See, he won't repent. That's what the seven implies here. You can't say that, preacher. Well, I'll bring a little more clarity. Is this making sense, my Ema? Okay. Fools don't like me. They hate me. You reprove a fool, you will get yourself a blot. Fool hates you. Back here in the book of Shemoth, Exodus 15:23. Shall be unclean for how many days? 7 days. I sure don't want my wife to be separated. Clean for 7 days. And all the bed wherein he lies shall be unclean. Sad thing when you all go on this trip, you know, you got to lay in a hotel room, huh? Okay then, just, all right. And then you wise, if something happens, you got to say, uh-oh. Go downstairs and tell the folks, it's unclean for 7 days. We got to wash, we got to clean. This is how silly, how men think. You're talking to a mind that has been encrusted with sin. It doesn't understand the words that he speaks. Yeshua spoke, he said, they're spiritual and they're life. He was the word of God. These are spiritual things. It takes a mind that is elevated above the flesh to understand. Verse 25. And if a woman has an issue of her blood many days, see that she is has an issue of blood. All right. For many days at the time of her nidah, that she's bleeding, that she's unclean. Or if it runs beyond the time of her separation of her nidah, that women that it runs longer than what she thought. And daddy says, I'm happy today because this is the day. I'm making it real, okay? And the days of the issue of her uncleanness shall be as the days of her separation. So shall she be unclean. Every bed whereupon she lies, the day of her issue shall be to her as a bed of nidah. It shall be unclean. Whosoever shall sit upon that shall be unclean. The uncleanness of her separation of her nidah. Verse 27. And whosoever shall touch those things shall be unclean. You all hear that? You know, if you get nothing I said out of that. So it's talking about a woman that goes beyond the days of her uncleanness, her nidah. She said, it should have been 5, 6 days, but it's in the 10th day. I don't know what's wrong. You understand? All women experience that, don't they? So it goes beyond the days of that. You all hear that? It says this now. And whosoever touch those things shall be unclean. Whosoever touch anything she touch, they shall be unclean. You all believe that? I do. I believe it. I'm glad the Torah can touch anything. I believe it. Now, you don't have the Bible. But I must give you an answer if I read that to you, my chont. I must draw the parallel in Torah. I must show you the power that you may have revelation. You can join in the abundance of Yah's testimony and the riches of his power in Yeshua. I must show you that. Whosoever touch the thing shall be unclean and shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water, and he shall be unclean until the evening. She had an issue, didn't she? She had an issue. Isn't this all about the issue of blood? She has gone beyond the days of her netah. She didn't even know it. Her husband sits on the bed. He's unclean. The younger comes in and gets some titty milk. The younger is unclean. You have to give us some kind of restitution to understand this and the power of this. And he has the answer for us. Can I give you the answer? Hold that and turn with me quickly to the book of Mark. The book of Mark. Hallelujah. Mark chapter 5 and verse 21. Mark 5:21. And while Yeshua, he had passed over again by ship to the other side, there were many people gathered to him, for he was near the Yam, the sea of life. And behold, there came one of the rulers of the Beit of Yah. His name was Yares by name. And when he saw him, he fell to Yeshua's feet. And he besought him greatly, saying, my little daughter, she's at home. She lies at the point of death. I pray you come and lay your hands on her that she may be healed and that she may live. And when Yeshua went in, there were many people that followed him, and they thronged on him. The people just pressed on him. Every kind of people pressed on him. Listen now. Torah talks about the woman that has an issue in a prolonged separation in Nida many days. What does that imply? I will show it's my path. It is all evidential here in Torah, but you got to know how to read Torah. You must be taught. You cannot become a chef unless someone teaches you. And a chef is always learning. Listen. It says this. That's why they're always elevating their dish. And Yeshua went with him, and the people followed him with the great throng. Verse 25. And a certain woman, which had, what did she have? An issue, a nida. A blood, how many years? Now, you all ought to know some numerology that represents the 12 tribes of Israel, doesn't it? Those 12 years that represent, and that's, we got a nida, we're filthy. What flows from our damn filthy minds, what flows from our murderous hearts. She had an issue of blood for 12 years. She has been on her period for 12 years. The blood has flown. Look what she did now. And had suffered many things of many physicians. And has spent all that she had. We spent everything. We spent everything on satisfaction, but it doesn't satisfy us. We spend everything on the healing of our own silly conscience, and we're not satisfied. We're trying to buy things that make us happy, and we're not happy. And she has been all she had, and she was not better, but rather she grew worse. This 12 years represent the whole house of Israel. We have an issue, the tribe of Naphtali, of Levi, Simeon. That's why it was 12. She did not have the issue for 10 years or 2 years. She had it for 12 years. We have an issue with Torah because we don't have the mind of the Ruach. We don't have the mind of Yeshua to understand the Torah. She was an unclean woman. By the Torah of Yah, she had a nida. She had a blood flowing out of her. And anything she touched was unclean. Anything she touched was unclean. She touched a bed, it was unclean. Anybody touched it, they were unclean. This is the stupidity of man. Listen to me, my bad. When she heard Yeshua come, Yeshua came in and she pressed behind, and she touched. Does it say touch? Did I talk about how if you touch anything that she's touched? Was Yeshua, did she touch Yeshua? These are silly boys. I like to play with boys. I actually think he thinks he can beat me in basketball. So sometime he will crow me. When you're ready. Come on. I said, let me get in some shape, man. We're going to run four. See now, even back there, he's like, yeah, you know you can't hang with me. I got it. He hasn't reached the maturity of his daddy yet. So I got him for a while. He'll get me eventually. But right now, I got you, boy. And I will play you next week, promise, full court. He may win, but I will win. He probably will win. But I will win. Now, what a friend. I won't provoke him to get upset when we preach a man. You cheated, puppy. Nah. The woman had an issue of blood for 12 years. Y'all hear that? It represents the issue out of the heart that defiles Yisrael. This is what's defiling us. You're angry as hell. You look dumb as hell. You get mad. You got a moody attitude. Your face express your... The Torah says this, that a man's countenance express what's in his heart. So when you see a man that got a nutty look on his face, and I don't care who you are. I'll tell this old man, I'll tell him, I would tell him. When you see a man with a nutty look on his face, he's expressing what's in his heart. When a man got this discomforting look on his face, always frown, he's expressing what's in his heart. That's what the Torah says. That's what Shirach says. Either he's a liar, he's telling us the truth. So the expression upon a man's face, he expressed what's in his own heart. Whatever's in your heart is expressed on you upon him. That's why you have to guard yourself. Is this making sense? Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. See, just like Zakain last week. These folks out there listening, they won't send a dime to keep us abreast. I mean, that we can extend this. And they've never heard this. They've never heard it. They've never heard it. And you that talk about it, you've never heard it. Can I go a little further? It says that this woman had an issue of blood for 12 years. She pressed behind Yahushua and she touched his garment. It says she touched his garment, right? Now hold that. Go back to Leviticus 15:27. Hold that in Marcus. Leviticus 15:27. And whosoever touched those things shall be unclean. She touched him, didn't she? She touched him, didn't she? Back to Marcus Lucas, all right? Hallelujah. She touched him. She touched his garment. For she said, if I may touch his clothes, seek the tassels. She said, I shall be made whole. I shall be complete. I shall be complete, my bath. In this sustaining power of Torah and how it elevates us and we grow in this. We may not understand the fullness of this at the moment, but we will as we go by and by. And the only way you're going to understand it is by emunah. How do we offer up the turtle doves and the offerings of the air? We can't do it to cleanse us. So we must offer up the sufficiency of one thing. Can I tell you? Will you believe me? One thing you offer up, Todah. You were filthy, we were unclean, just offer up Todah. These men are trying to make proselytes to themselves. And they cause them to fall the children of hell and make them even dumber when they try to talk with experience and knowledge they don't have. Listen now, she touched him. Was he unclean? He is the living Torah. Was he unclean? Anything that they touched was unclean. If even you talk to your friend and some of the spittle went on him, he was unclean until the evening. Was Yahushua unclean? No, he wasn't unclean. You can't read one verse and think you have the understanding of that man. A woman, stop that. You try to base a doctrine on that, that's wrong. Just be quiet and let Yah bring the knowledge of that to you. And by as you go, he'll bring a little sister. Because you hear, brother, that will cause faith to rise in your heart to understand that better. Look what it says. And straightway the fountain, it's talking about the nidah, the filthiness. When you touch him, straightway, Yisrael. When you touch by the suit, straightway, you cleanse. When this Torah touch you, straightway, you cleanse. Not tomorrow, not 7 days. Hell no. Yeah, I'm saying hell no. Not 7 days, today. It says when she touched him right away, straightway, the fountain of her blood was dried up. And she felt in her body, she was healed of that nigah, that plague. Hallelujah. She represents the embodiment in that body, the woman. This is the woman that Leviticus is talking about. She represents the embodiment, the power of all Yisrael. And these dumb men do not have the ability to articulate that because they don't know how to study. I do. I learned how to from day one. Can I tell you how? They were singing the song. One day at a time, sweet Yahushua. That's all I ask of you. I sing in this way. One word at a time from the Torah. You got to take one word at a time. Every word that he speaks is pure and is ever to him, his servants. We take refuge in it. Every word is pure. One word at a time. They take volumes. And they try to explain volume in 5 or 6 words. It doesn't work that way. This woman is the embodiment of Yisrael. We got all kinds of issues. I got issue with her. She got issue with her. She got issue with her. You got issue with her. She got issue with. He got issues with him. He got issue with him. Him. We got issues, Yisrael. We have a nidah. We have an unclean thing. And if we will confess our faults one to another. And the effectual fervent. See how the woman, she was healed, wasn't it? So that's why he said we must confess our issues. And then we have fervent prayer. I want to see the wise men. I want to see the elderly men, the zachin, wise when they walk, when they talk. I know what I am. The children tell me that. I'm so fat I can't get my arms back there, that's all. And so that's how you know who you are. It's the babies, the innocent, they have nothing to offer but their friendship and love. That's how I know what I'm right. I examine that by them. I don't examine myself by Yosipia. Hell, he could be in the same moody spirit I'm in today. Children are the same. They're the same. They get mad and they're not mad. Children are the same. We are the silly ones. Can I move a little farther here? We are silly as they come. I got it right. I got it right. Yeah, the Torah is revealed to me. Everybody doesn't possess what everyone has. You're silly to think that. Hallelujah. It says that this woman, she is the embodiment of the nation of Yisrael. And what this implies here, can I tell you? It implies this. We must always trust in the living Torah. She said, if I could just touch this word, if I can get this word to touch me, I know I'll be made whole. And we can get this word to touch the issues in us. Let the Torah touch the issues in you. Let it touch that flow of nidah, those unclean things in you. Let the preaching and the counsel of the Torah touch what's in you and show you what's in you. If you allow that to touch you, you will be healed, Yisrael. The young man that wrote me about his pornography, he allowed the Torah to touch him. He will be healed of that. It must first of all convince you that you're wicked and your ways are unclean. And then the Torah will restore you. He sent forth the Torah to heal us. That's why he sent forth Joshua to heal that woman with all of those issues. He was saying that Yisrael, you got issues. You got plenty of issues. Back in the days, people would say, you got issues, girl. You never heard that? Huh? Girlfriends would say to girlfriends, girl, you got issues. I don't know if we men said it like that. But I know women would say it. I would hear them say, girl, you got issues. Okay, so my chut came. She said, yeah. They would say, you got issues. And that's our response. You got issues. It ain't the circumstance. You got issues. Hallelujah. You might as well love me. Might as well. And so she knew that when she touched the beauty of Torah, she knew according to the Torah that if she touched him, he would be unclean. I'm so glad that he bore our sins and our wickedness on that stake at Calvary. He was not sullen, he was not scarred, and he was not filthy. Because if that had been the case, the skin worm would have ate him. He didn't rot, he didn't stink, he rose up like he said he would. And that's what we must do, rise up in the power of Torah. Hallelujah. Look what it says here. I don't know if I'm going to finish today. I'll get enough of it, though. It says in verse 30, and Joshua immediately, knowing in himself, look what went out of him. It says virtue, right? We know what virtue is. The word virtue in the Hebraic is chayil, the strength. The word chayil emphasizes above all one thing, an army really to fight the battle. So the army of the seven ruachim, the seven spirits of Yah, 7 days, seven ruachim. It says he knew that virtue had gone out of him. He turned himself about in the presence and said, who touched my clothes? If that near that woman had touched anything, the bed, he had touched her, he was unclean until the evening. And if he was unclean until the evening, you know what it signifies above all things? That the Torah of Yah can be polluted. And you cannot pollute the Torah of Yah. You got to read with understanding. If you don't read nothing but one verse a night, just ponder that, ponder that, ponder, 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 ponder. Don't say I'm going to read three chapters tonight. Read one verse or three verses and ponder and ponder and let it refresh in your mind and go over it. Don't try to read like you're reading a damn story book. And then the words in those verses will captivate you. You crack over the concordance and begin to search out words of the same magnitude. And then you will get clarity of that. Silly man, all he does is read. I don't read. I don't read the Torah. I meditate, I study upon Torah. Listen, he knew that something had gone out of him. That immediately he knew, and he said, who touched my garment? And his Talmudim said to him, you see the multitudes, man, thronging you, and you say, who touched me? And he looked around about to see her that had done this thing. She knew she was wrong. She knew she wasn't right. The Pharisees would have stoned her to death. She shouldn't have been out. We cannot go out of the way of Yah. They would have killed her. We caught this woman in the act of adultery. You know what Torah says. He stooped down and began to write. Now, he didn't call them name, tell them their secrets. They knew this. Torah knew the secrets of the heart. But the dam of your shoe cleansed this. They didn't know how to answer that. That's what it says. They didn't know how to answer him. They did not. It says, and the woman, see the first ruach of Yah that fell upon her? The ruach ham, what is it? Fearing. Yira, yareah. It says that the fear of Yah, in order for us to get wisdom and understanding, we must fear Yah, we must yare. And she began to tremble. She began to tremble. See, men will teach this, but they don't teach the elements of this. It says fear. What I would do, I would search out all the scriptures on fearing in the whole book. And it would draw the conclusion what this means. Well, I could teach you, but I'm not going to teach that today. She began to fear and tremble. That's yira. That's yareh, fear and tremble, trembling with great reverence. Isn't that one of the ruachim of Yah, the fear of Yah? Isn't that not one of the ruachim of Yah, the fear of Yah? Isn't that one of the seven? Isn't that what you understand what that menorah represents? It represents each ruachim of Yah. That's what that represents. You don't even know that. That's what it represents. That's what the seven lights, the ruachim, the ma'or of Yah. Well, that's pagan, go to hell. Silly boy. When I say that go to hell, you all hear me. I'm simply saying your words, let them go down to Sheol. Let them go down to the grave with you. They don't mean nothing to me. But fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, she came and fell down before him, didn't she? And then what did she do? She did what? Say it again. Told him some of the truth, as Zacchaeus. He puts you on the spot. I can't do. Told him a portion of the truth. Told him a little bit of the truth. Told him all the truth. She confessed. That's what Torah commands for us. That we walk in the truth of Torah. She told him all the truth. She told him all the truth. See, we don't want to say that I'm moody today. I'm silly as hell. Forgive me. We don't want to say I'm stupid. I'm so immature. We don't want to say I'm sorry. I'm just sorry. She told him all the truth. Does the Torah tell us all the truth? Yes. It tells us all the truth, doesn't it? She told him all the truth. That's what I read to you in Leviticus, all the truth. Who is the fulfillment of truth? Yeshua HaMashiach. I am HaDerech. I am HaImet. I am Chayeh. That's what he is. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is Chayeh. See, that's where she began. She told him all the truth. She knew she had issues. Well, sister, I got an issue with you. Tell her all the truth. I got it. Tell him all the truth, you damn hypocrite. She told all the truth. She didn't tell some of it. She told all the truth. I'm unclean. I shouldn't have touched you. I knew it was wrong. And the elders would have got me and rebuked me and stoned me. She told him all the truth. No use of searching, trying to find something. She told him all the truth. She told him all the truth. That's the key, Yisrael. Because Yah has given us all his truth. She told him all the 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 truth. We must live honest with all men. We must live honest with each other. You must tell all the truth. I can say, I know that people hear me say that I've never lied to my wife about nothing. I have not lied to her when there were women that were drawn to me. I go home and tell her. I've never lied to her about money because we've never had money. I've never had to lie to her to cover some kind of situation because I never hung with cats. I hung by myself and I hung with her. That's the only person I've hanged with all my 36 years, the last of them. So I've never had to lie about anything. I've never had to lie to hide anything or to conceal. I haven't had to do that. And so when women, my deliverance was when I would tell her. And tell you the story, I was in Denver, Colorado. I was out there for 3 weeks. And where I was at in Boulder, you had this mentality of everybody there, you will see the Bellotrons of riders. But people will go there to train for the Olympics and the sports because of the high altitude. It was high altitude there. You had to be right to survive there. And I'll never forget, I went into the dining area and there was this woman. She was fit as they come. She was fit. Most men would have said, yes, sir. Nobody then knew me. Nobody was around. It was darker. She says, who are you? I want to say, heifer, don't approach me like that. It's not you to approach someone, you 2-cent whore. That's not relevant who I am. What are you doing? I'm waiting for a friend. I went to Estes Park. The woman said to me, she said this, and I was young and virile and stronger, much stronger than I am now. So why not do it now, then, and I can cover it. Her friend comes over. And she looked just like her. And she says, who is this? They didn't see many black hue skin of men out there. They didn't see with dark hue like mine. You understand? Very few. Truth. Children would see me because I was muscular and say, daddy, look, look, look. They didn't see many. So they say to me, when you come back, we'll be here. We're going to be here for a while. I don't know if they were prostitutes with AIDS or what. I didn't give a damn. It was about 8 a.m. that time. It was about 9 at home. I'll never forget. When I went past that place, the devil said, boy, they're in there waiting on you. You can be the stud Johnson. I'm just explaining this event. Many like that. When I got, before I got there, I got on me a jog. I got my jog on. You understand? I got my jog on. And I ran to the hotel room. I couldn't wait. Didn't have no cell phone back then. I couldn't wait. Dit, 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 dit. Baby, can I tell you what? Where are you? I was in bed. So let me just tell you what happened. See, I could have not done that and went out later on and just put on my... Yeah, I could have. So I've never had to lie to about that. I've never been enticed to that degree whereby I wanted to void my commitment. I've never done it. I just wasn't that way. Not that I was right or I possess any damn thing. I don't possess a damn thing. Even the man who has done it, he is of the same nature as I am. We're wicked and we're filthy without the dam of Yahshua. Not some ritual of tradition. Without that blood, we're... She told him everything. She told him everything. She told everything. That's what the Torah commands. When you go to the Kohan, you have to tell everything. She told the chief one, I'm filthy. She told him everything. Listen, listen to what it says. But she was trembling. She told him everything. Hallelujah. She told him everything. She was trembling. She fell down. She told him everything. See, only then when we confess our sins, that's when we're healed. And it says this. And he said to her, my bath, my daughter of Yisra'iyah. He said, your faith. Your emunah, not some tradition, not some washing. Your faith has made you whole. Because she had washed many times and she was not whole. She had washed many times, she wasn't clean. She tried to make herself right with resolution, she wasn't right. But she trusted in that Torah. And that's what we must do, Yisrael. Don't let men put burdens on you. They come to you with that bull jive, tell them to go to hell. I don't care who it is. These are unlearned men. They don't know the Torah of Yah. And men, I just don't crack them open because I love them and I don't want to destroy them. There are men that said, I would destroy you, man, in a game of basketball. They don't destroy them because they have an emotion for them. I never played him one-on-one, but I knew that would have been a game. My boy there in his prime and me in my prime, I wanted him. But I said, nah, the way I whipped him every time I played against him. He checked me and I checked him and everything was clean and tight and right and honor. You understand? And I never tried to challenge him, did I? Come on, you and me. The only way, only thing we would do, and he would wear me out, we would put the ball, look, he would not do me the way I did him. We had to shoot three-pointers, and the one who rebounded had to pump the ball where they wanted to. So I'm with him, I'm pumping here, I'm pumping there, I'm pumping here, back there, trying to throw him off because I knew he gonna hit. With me, he up here, throw it right there. The next shot, he gonna throw that. He didn't treat me like, I didn't care. I treated him like a dog. Yeah, I did. I treated him viciously because I wanted him to miss. And he had enough on, he said, now, preacher, I ain't gonna do you like that. He, boom. Every now and then, he'd say, okay. And then he'd toss it in a way that Abner could run the ball down. I wasn't doing him like that. I put him where he gotta run fast and hard, trying to wear him out. So his jump shot began to fall short. She confessed everything. That's where we began. We confess everything. He said, my daughter, your faith has made you whole. He said, go in shalom. So he did not say, go wash yourself. He said, go in shalom and be whole of your issue, your negah, your plague, and the issue of your heart. Behold, he didn't say go wash in the pool of Siloam. He did not say go wash in the basins of the temple. He did not say that. He said, that's what the Torah commands us. That's what it tells us. Yah gives us a dictate to orchestrate the beauty of his power. If only one thing, if we just obey him in all things, all these stipulations will not be added. When a mother trusts the daughter of the son when they go out for an event, she said, you'll be home at 9. And when the daughter, she has never failed that, she knew. The son has never failed that. It's only when they fail that, they began to worry. That's why y'all had this, and because we have failed the test from day one. That's why. And I like this next part. If she, it says, he says to her, you are made whole. And my daughter, he says, daughter, he said, your faith has made you whole, and go in shalom. Now go quickly back to, I want to close in a minute. I got a few verses I want to close. I'm not going to be able to teach all this. We'll get with the part with the purification offering. See, all of this issue, you have to have purification offering. See, you got to teach all that. If you're going to teach that, the application of it, and show the people how to come from under that, show the women they don't come in the house of Yah like that. Show the men they don't even come in the house of Yah like that. He says it back in Weyira, Leviticus 15:28. It says, look now, in Leviticus 15:28, but if she be cleansed of her issue, her zoo, Then she shall number to herself 7 days, and after that she shall be cleansed. Now, Yahshua says she was cleansed. See, that's what the Torah is trying to tell us. If we truly trust Torah, you will be cleansed. And the seven always relate to the seven, the perfection of Torah, to the perfection of the Ruachim of Yah. This woman showed immediate wonder. The fear of Yah is the beginning of wisdom. She knew that this was living Torah. And so because she trembled, she feared Yah, and she had wisdom. And when the woman, when this woman get that Ruachim of the seven Ruachim, she will fear Yah and she will exercise wisdom. Yeah. We have slackish men at the gate. They're soft and they're wicked. They're spongy. They're full of lust and they're unclean. They got issues out of them. And yet they wreak havoc on the woman and try to put such a hard task on her. It's the same for the man. No different. They all have issues. We are one house. This is a doctrine of parity. Hallelujah.
Get to that.
My Zochain Davis out there, I know you're all hearing this. I know you are, my friend. We're coming to Cali to tear the mother down, all right? The mother of all harlotry is there. Cali, California. Hallelujah. It says in verse 28 of Leviticus, but if she be cleansed of her zub, her issue, then she shall number herself 7 days and she shall be clean. It said on the eighth day, look now, she shall take to her two turtle doves. Did Yahshua tell her that? Did he tell her to take two turtle doves? Same thing. You got to take two turtle doves like the men. Why don't you preach that, you damn hypocrite? You must take two turtle doves and two young pigeons and bring them to the Kohan at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and the Kohan shall offer it up for sin offering. Yeshua says, go in shalom. That's what the Torah tells us. He said, go in shalom. And that's the living power of the Torah. Go in shalom. You confess all. That's what the Kohan represents, the confession. And he hath offered the burnt offering. It says, and the Kohan shall offer up the sin offering and the other for a burnt offering. You tell me that must be a burnt offering? Yeshua is the burnt offering. He is the Holocaust. He's the whole offering. He's the offering of wholeness. He is the one that has been offered for us. And the Kohan shall make the kafar atonement for her before Yah and for the issue of her uncleanliness. Yeshua paid the price. He made the atonement for her sin. That's why he said, woman, go into law. You are clean. He's telling the 12 tribes of Israel, stop letting the issues prevent you from loving each other and walking right. Stop these little boys from filling your ears with silly mess. Listen to a messenger of Yah. Listen to a man of strength. Hallelujah. Quit listening to your silly mind. You don't know. We must be instructed and counseled in the Torah of Yah. That's how you get faith. I like enemies. I like enemies. Because I'm a warrior. I'm not a weak boy. I'm a warrior. Or I'm strong like you know you're not. The old men think that they're stronger. They're not strong. They couldn't lift 50 pounds in the natural sense. Think they can fight. Oh, silly old man. They don't have a damn thing. They do that to those that they think that they can overwhelm. You want to fight someone? Come to me, coward ass. I knock you out. And we're talking to you, Jacob down there in Tampa. He used to box in the Marines. But I'm a warrior. In between a Marine and a warrior. A Marine like just a few. Yah has, listen, the few, the proud, the strong in the Marine. Yah has any. Greater than the few. I still got a little bit. There's so much. Let me close from here. And Yah's will, I want to pick this up at some other time, all right? Is that all right, Zachina Ramia? I want you all to hear this, and I tell you where it is when I finish. Yah says this. Listen to it. And now, oh Yah, our Abba, what shall we say after this? First of all, for we have Asa, we have forsaken Torah. We have not hidden it in our heart, that which you have written in there. We have allowed the issues to contaminate it. We have forsaken the Torah. Listen, we have, which you have commanded us by your servants. He commanded us by the Navi'im, the prophets, saying, this what this messenger tell you today. Hear this, Yisrael. The land, the promises, the Dabarim, the word of Abraham, Yitzchok, and Yaakov, the promises, the land, to which you go and possess, lay hold of it, to establish the government of the Torah. It says, it is an unclean land with nida, filthiness of the people of the land with their abominations, which they have filled it from one end to another with their uncleanliness. That's what the nida woman represents. We're in a land that the filthiness or the nida, like if you go to California, Jefferson, South Carolina is filthy. Anywhere in the world, you can go from North Dakota to the Keys of Florida, from Texas, even up unto Iowa, Idaho. He said the land that you go and possess is a filthy land. It's a land that has an issue. It flows with nida blood. It flows continuously with the blood, with the nida, with the issues of the minds of the people. They fight and they grapple like dogs. They have no compassion, no consideration. That's what the Nobi, the scribe Ezra said to the nation of his people. First Ezra 9 10 and 11, First Ezra, that the land is filthy because of the Ninah, because of the blood. We will not tell all. We will not tell all. And that's the greatest strength we possess. I'm a filthy liar. I do lie. Just help me. And so when you lie, someone say, all right, now that sound like a lie. No, I'm being honest on that one, really. We must confess all. Hallelujah. And if we don't confess all this nidah, this filthiness, hallelujah, I'm going to continue this one day. I don't know when. That is the answer to all my critics.
You that right and you that say that, well, the woman should not come in.
What about the man?
Hallelujah.
It's the same. Women don't have issues, you silly boy. You don't even know the Torah. You don't have the ability. Our Zachin Yeshurun could not come back in this house. Why is his name? You know what the name Yarrafa means? He is our healer. He is our Mufe. And the issue is the Nidah. You got fluids that are running out of you. You are unclean. You got fluids running out of your buttocks, your legs, or any part of you. There's an issue. You are unclean. And the fluid that we become, you know, they will use this word. Well, she is fluidic. The fluidity of a speech. We got a fluid that flow out of our mouths that is nothing but guile and so damn wicked, so vile. And that's the fact. That is the truth. And by the way, if you love me, it's all right. If you don't, I like that. Makes me no different because I'm not here for one damn penny. If I was, I could have taught this in an intellectual way that even professors would have said, oh man, I tell you, man, that the way you bring that stuff out, man, it is not like I've heard before, man. I tell you, preacher, y'all has blessed you so wonderfully. Tell us that again. Oh, how I want to send you 5,000. Can I send that? Yes. I know how to do it. It doesn't take much to deceive me because, first of all, you know why? Can I say this? Because men deceive themselves. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Men deceive themselves to think they're strong. They deceive themselves to think that they can really rock with that. They deceive themselves thinking they can. I still can shoot that ball. They deceive themselves in many manners. So do women.
How do I look, baby?
Baby, that's showing my issue. I say, that's... If I did that to her, she'd tell me, she'd say, there it is. She'd tell me, well, you asked me. There it is, baby. Well, you know, what's wrong? You can't see that woman. Okay, you asked me. Baby, take that off. That's what I want to wear. No, look, you didn't say that the last time I wore. Well, you know, you. Maybe it's got a little small on me. No, it ain't got a little small on you. You pumped it up a little bit, Big Daddy. And I'm your king, and this is the way you talk to me, woman. You talk to me that way. You tell me that. Because I don't like that. I don't like that. Don't tell me that. Can you suck it in or something like that? No, I ain't sucking it in. I'm letting it flow. What's wrong with that? Just don't come from behind the. That's what she tells me. Just stay up there. Don't come from behind that. Because that's going to be seen. Get out of my face, woman. That's where I say, get out of my face. You asked me to tell you the truth. I don't want to hear that, though. Tell me I look nice. Oh, the same response if I tell her. Get that off. Tight on your ass like that. You got men behind you, woman. Don't wear that. Get that mess off. What are you like? I said, no, but it's tight on your ass now. Get it off. I talk like that. Yeah, I talk to my woman. Tight on your ass. It doesn't look right. Get it off. You might as well love me. Greetings to you all, our friends. May the riches of Yad Yeshua HaMashiach rest upon you all. If the word has been an inspiration, I know my verbiage is not the most charming and precise. I know my delivery is somewhat adequate. It doesn't have the polishness of a man that is of the acute nature of verbology, that he speaks in a way that is so beautiful that even the birds tweak. Send an offering. I don't possess those characteristics. Send a gift to help. But I tell you the truth. If I give you nothing else, you've gotten the truth today. We as men, we must stop putting the people of Yah in bondage. We can't do that. And as simple-minded ones, there's a family that lives up north. So I've gotten on the daughter hard. She writes me yesterday and I get on her. And these are words. Now, this is what broke me about everything. You know what broke me? She says, yes, Riak, you asked me how long have I been serving Yah? And I said, we've all of our lives. She said, but the thing of it is, yes, we've done that. But we haven't heard someone that talk the way you talk and to make things understandable the way you do. It's different. We haven't heard it like that. And we know it's right. And we know it's real. Wait, no. She said that. I'm like, don't do me like that. I want to be tough today. And it just broke me because she said that. She knows who she is if she's listening. She said, we just haven't heard it like that. You bring it out different than we've ever heard it. No, it is the Ruach HaKodesh. When he comes, he shall not speak of himself. But those things, see, you got to have the Ruach to speak of the things that were heard in the day when he said to Moshe, if a man has an issue, you got to be there when the word was. And Yahshua was with the Father from the beginning. So you need the Ruach. You need the life. The Ruach HaKodesh is just the life of Yah. That's his power in us. He is not a spirit. He is Ruach. You need to get rid of your damn Holy Ghost and your fag Jesus and your damn talk about the Lord God. All right? Hallelujah. You can be a faggot and be a Christian. And so when she said that, I haven't heard it like this. And we just, I believe what you said. I know what you said is the truth. You know why it's the truth? Because it's simple. You can understand. Men that want to complicate things and cause you to be go through a litmus test, they want to complicate it. Say, well, see, that's what it said. But you didn't read the two verses above that. People will call me and say, hold up. Well, that's what it says, preacher. I said, hold up. Now, let's get the essence of what he's talking about right here. Go up to verse 1. Now, let's read down to verse 11, then you understand. Then they get quiet. They can't say nothing. They get quiet. Well, just like that I just read. May the riches of Yah rest upon you. Oh, may strengthen your bosom in Yeshua's name. Our Zachin Zachin. Ramayah, he's going to dismiss us. We bless you all, Yisrael. Send an offering, a gift to help in the labor of Yah's love to strengthen.
Hallelujah. Well, what can we say, Yisrael, but Todah? Todah Yah. Hallelujah. The Yahweh deemed us worthy of his truth and of his Torah, that we may. Not that we should fall back, but that we should move forward. Hallelujah. And like they would say, the runners would say, I got to jump ahead. Hallelujah. Yahweh has given us a jump ahead, Yisrael. Yeah. So let us continue forward. Let us press forward. Let us not regress. Let us move on, that we will be in the will and in the place where Yahweh desires us to be. Hallelujah. And I barak Yahweh for that and for the dom of Yahshua HaMashiach, hallelujah, hallelujah, that has cleansed us, that has redeemed us from you and from me, hallelujah. So let us stand to our feet with the knowledge of Yahshua HaMashiach, Abba Yahweh, that he has redeemed us from the hands of our enemy, hallelujah. Almighty Yahweh, we told you for this beautiful Shabbaton. We do ask, Abba Yahweh, those that are here, those that are listening by via of live stream, Abba Yahweh, that you will continue to reassure and to encourage your house, Abba Yahweh, that you have laid a path and a way that is so perfect and that is so beautiful. And all that you ask of us as a people is just to walk therein. So, Abba Yahweh, we do toda, you, we give you toda. We do ask those that have come from near and afar, Abba Yahweh, that you would strengthen them, that you would take them home safely, Abba Yahweh. And as you always do so faithfully, that your melekim, your messengers, your Torah, will be encamped round about Kol Yisrael. And all things we do barak you. And we toda you, Abba Yahweh, truly for this day. And all things in Yahshua's name we do declare. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Yahweh. Hallelujah. Yabara Yisrael, Kol Yisrael. Hallelujah.